I get really tired of, and I'm not talking about SL, I'm talking about RL as well. I get tired of hearing these people going on here just whining and crying about every little thing. So I don't deal with it. I don't pay attention to it. However, when it does come to the SL wrestling part, when things are said, or and not necessarily about me, but necessarily like maybe the Fed that I'm in, or maybe even friends that I have, and I'm hearing these nasty little comments, you know, that are being made, and I think I know what you're talking about.
Whoa! I'm not. Hey, I found a real hardcore chip. I'm not talking about anybody in particular. I mean, I'm not talking about nobody.
Well, wait a minute, though. If you say you found the real hardcore champion, that means that the hardcore champion has to be a person unless you've come up with some kind of cyborg.
I'm not talking about any SL drama, BK. I know there's a lot of things said about me. I don't pay attention to none of that. I'm all about business. But today we're going to show the real hardcore champion, and they're going to be in the ring, and I'll tell you what, it's going to be something. You wait and see.
Well, I mean, you know, we're definitely, like you said, you know, no better way to bring than to do it than to have you here. Ladies and gentlemen, we do know for a fact that we are going to be getting an announcement that's going to be made. And honestly, I was not told who was going to be making it. I was just told that a member of management was going to be coming out here and making a big announcement here at the beginning of the show, just a few minutes away. I have no idea what's going on. And then today is going to be a show for OEW like we have never seen. I mean, Paul, you've heard what's been going on backstage. There's been a lot of buzz going on backstage and things like that. This is going to be an outrageous show, and it's going to be
I think it's going to be a nice fitting way to go out, especially not just for OEW. And I'm not talking as the scumbag superstar now. I'm talking, this is the real guy talking, you know. We're not going out today for, you know, for that's not just OEW, but for all our friend, and that's the Omen. You know, Omen, me and Omen worked together. I know you and Omen worked together. A lot of people worked with Omen. And today's is going to be a fitting ending for him as well, for his passing that we recently found out about. So today's going to be a special day, not just for OEW, but for Omen as well. And I'm honored, truly honored to be out here.
Yeah, absolutely, and you know, and playing into what you said about Omen. I mean, whether you liked the guy or whether you didn't, he did have a huge impact on SL Wrestling in the time that he was with us, and a lot of this stuff is going to be addressed here in just a little bit. But like I said, I don't know who's going to be saying it. I don't know what to expect because, like I said, there's been a lot of things going on this week and a lot of things have been having to twist around because of circumstances. But it's all going to be straightened out here in just a little bit. So,
BK, let me tell one quick Omen story. And you know this story.
I think I know which one you're talking about. All right, go ahead.
Omen was a part of this story, and my very first time here in SL Wrestling was introduced. I was a complete noob, and I went to Premier Wrestling to start out, and the Omen introduced me to everybody, and the Omen walked me around the, you know, the Premier Wrestling facilities and everything, introduced me to people, and I come to BK. As BK's coming in, Omen says, "Hey, this is BK. He's one of our wrestlers here. BK, this is Paul. He's going to be our new commentator here at Premier." At that moment, in real life, my mic went down, and I'm trying to fix my mic. BK says, "Hey, how you doing? Nice to meet you." I don't respond because I'm fixing my mic, and BK says, "Oh, great, another commentator with no voice. See you later," and walks away. And Omen says to me as we're walking away, "Hey, man, that's just BK. It's how he is. Don't take it personal."
Yeah.
True story.
That honestly is a very true story. And what even makes it funnier is the fact that it wasn't, and let's be honest, you know, when we did what we did earlier in the year with our story and everything, and we brought a lot of RL into our storyline, it was one of those things that it wasn't until you and I started discussing doing this that you told me then that, oh, yeah, by the way, asshole, my mic wasn't working. And I looked at you and said, okay, asshole. All you had to do was type and say, hey, my mic's not working. That's all you had to do.
That bothered me. That bothered me so much. That bothered me so freaking much.
I know it did. But that's for another time. That's a story that we'll have to lay out sometime or another. We'll sit down sometime or another and let everybody know what happened with the history and all that. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we're about 10 seconds away from OEW's last stand. So if you got time to get some people in here, get them in here. Put them on your side of the barricade because we do have itchy trigger fingers around here ready to eject them. Here we go.
To the last call, we bled, we fought, we gave our all. The moments, the glory, the rise, the fall. Over the edge, we stood tall. Now the curtain falls, the light's still low, but the legacy forever will glow. This is the final stand where legends are made. We walk through fire unafraid. The fight may end, but the spirit lives on in every heart, in every song. Show one final roar, over the edge forevermore. Over the edge, forevermore. The crowd may fade, the doors may close, but every punch, every pain it shows. We were warriors, rebels at heart, and nothing can tear that apart. We fought for pride, we fought for love, and now we rise, we're final show. This is the final stand where legends are made. We walk through fire unafraid. The fight may end, but the spirit lives on in every heart, in every song. One last show, one final roar.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to OEW Final Stand. I am BK Tigerfish, the former executive liaison to OEW, but commentator today. And joining me for the last show for OEW, you all remember we used to get together. We were on the shows a lot, but it's great to have him back for one last Final Stand. Everybody, the scumbag superstar, Paul Slater.
BK, it's great to be here. It's actually great to be here with you. It's a great way to end OEW, and it's a great way to honor our friend who recently passed, the Omen. I think it's going to be a special show today. It's going to be a great show, and we think we're going to have a lot of fun, and it's going to be a great, great send-off for the Omen and a great send-off for the OEW's Final Stand.
Absolutely, and one thing that I want to let everybody know is that throughout the show, you know, between matches and stuff like that, I know that I'm going to, and Paul, I'm sure you're going to as well, but we will be sharing stories that, whether publicly known about it or just like conversations, you know, between myself and Omen or maybe Paul and Omen or whatever, and tell you what kind of, you know, what kind of impression that even today, the fact that, you know, I'm on the comms and I'm not even in the ring as much as I was. The impact and the guidance that he actually helped me to get to where I am today.
Yeah, I mean, same, like I shared the story earlier, the same thing. Omen is the one who introduced me to SL Wrestling. He's the one to train me. And actually, my very first time I commentated, my very, very first time commentated, because of that, he sat with me and did comms with me and made me feel more comfortable and made me fit right in. And I'll always remember that with Omen. I have a lot of stories about Omen. I have a lot of videos, actually funny videos that I'll share on my Twitter page after the show with the Omen in it, of outtakes and things, the promos that we did before. So, it's a sad day, but you know what? It's also a celebration for Omen and everything he's done for OEW and SL Wrestling.
Absolutely. And ladies and gentlemen, I understand that we have an announcement that's going to be made. I do not know who's going to be making this. I know that one of the managers, one of the powers that be, so I'm told that they're ready to go. So listen up.
know how I like them. A little loud, a little crazy, and,
so this is going to be my last time climbing into an OEW ring. It's so surreal. I mean, look back through the years, I was in the original OEW. This OEW came back and it was amazing. An amazing almost 4 years, an amazing reign of terror as VP of operations. But the saddest part is, the one person missing to see all of this, he's not here. And that makes it even sadder. And, you know, Omen was a giant, giant, not only in the ring, but he was also a best friend, a brother, loved by many. And I want to say so much about Omen right now, but before I even get into that, like BK and Paul were saying, today is it. Today is the day that we close the doors of the OEW. Today is not a day that any of us, any of the talent in the back or myself, ever thought was going to happen this soon. We thought we were going to at least, you know, tell our stories for a little longer. So please sit back and relax and let us entertain you one last time. But before we get this show started and before we memorialize Omen to start the show, I have one more person who has something to say. Brittany, do me a favor, honey. Play that music.
And ladies and gentlemen, the VP of Operations, Tiesa, is bringing out her own surprise guest. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the music for the one and only Derek Zane.
Wow. You know, PK, I heard about this guy, Derek Zane. I heard about this guy's a legend.
Legend doesn't even cover what the, I don't get starstruck in SL wrestling too often, but I'm not gonna lie, I am right now. I've heard of him, I've seen him in action. This is the closest I've ever been to him. I'm like banging her right now.
This is unbelievable. I heard about this guy's name coming up all the time.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, Derek Zane, Mr. Zane, the match are yours.
I'm going to be honest, this is not the most fortuitous way I ever saw myself re-entering an OEW ring. It certainly is a heavy day. So if you'll forgive me, I'm going to tell a little bit of a story. Before I became Derek Zane, I had spent about 4.5 years doing this in the actual real world. I'd been trained by Andre Verdun and Eddie Carnage Gonzalez, and to a smaller amount by Supreme. So I have real world knowledge of this business. And one day, I was on Second Life, and I was bored. And I was looking around for something to do, and I just, on a lark, typed in pro wrestling. And I saw a name, and it was XWA. And I went to XWA, you now know them as VWE. And I watched what they were doing, and I saw what they were doing was the business. It was what I had been training to do. It's what I had been doing for a short while. I thought, well, that's interesting. I'll ask some questions. And I did. I was told that there was no real spot for anybody at this time, but maybe come back later, or I could go check over at a place called DCWF. So I went there, and I watched what they did, and I filled out an application, and I never heard back. So taking it upon myself, I got the ACPWS, the Alpen Chris Pro Wrestling System, and I trained myself in how to do this. And then I told a friend of mine by the name of Lex Umaga, because I knew he was interested in wrestling. And he got a kick out of it. Then he said, hey, I know this guy. His name is David Hawk Actor. What if you and me, we bring him in on this? And I said, yeah, sure, why not? And then the three of us had an idea. We were working for what could be charitably called indie promotions in SL. Savannah Mohegan was one of the people that we worked for a very small amount of time. But the idea was to make a place where you wouldn't be told, we got no spot for you, or that you would be ignored and your application would never be responded to. And that was this, OEW. A place where misfits, the unwanted, the undesired could go and have an opportunity, a chance to make what they could of it. And that was all that was promised, was an opportunity, a chance to get your foot in the door and be a part of this. Time has a way of revealing mistakes. I've made them. When I last left OEW, it was not under my best of terms. I did not expect to ever see this place open again, but it did. And the fact that it stayed alive in the 7 years that I was gone from Second Life is a testament to what this place is. The fact that I am here now on a day when we are honoring a man I never even got a chance to meet, but I understand was on my bucket list, makes it even more of a heavy day. So I want you to understand why I'm emotional about this. This was the start of my journey here in SL. So if this is its last day, and if OEW never again returns, remember this. This merry band of pirates, this cast-off crew of people that nobody gave a shit about, other than ourselves, we managed to do something that no one gave us the even thought that we could. We made a place for ourselves. We did it on our terms, and we did it gloriously. So, I'm going to stop yakking. We're going to get on with this show. We're going to entertain the fuck out of all of you. And you are never, ever going to forget the name Over the Edge Wrestling.
All of us here at OEW want to thank Derek for coming in and saying that. And I mean, Jesus Christ, you and I are good at promos. How the hell do we follow that?
You can never follow Derek Zane after that one.
I know.
I'm sorry, but those are some big shoes to fill. So let's do exactly what Derek Zane just said. Let's get on with this show. And this entire show will be for Omen. So, to all the talent in the back, please come on out for that last ride.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, as the roster makes their way to the back to put on a show for you all, I'm going to take this opportunity to tell my first Omen story. You know, Paul told his earlier, and this is mine. There was a time when I was in Premier Wrestling and I had met Omen, and I had gone from being a commentator and had gotten into the ring, and I was asked to go back to the comms table. Omen had come in and he was telling me, you know, hey, you know, BK, I can help you out. I got some ideas for you. Now, as it's known, you know, Omen did have a small speech impediment and everything, which made it even more endearing talking to him, you know. But this was this particular day. I don't know if he was having a bad day, but he was sitting down and he was talking to me on voice and he was trying to give me some pointers. And he was having issues getting the words out because sometimes, as you know, it happens with all of us, you know, our brains work faster than our mouths. And he was struggling, you know, and I was listening and everything. And finally he just stopped and kind of chuckled and looked at me and says, "You're a goddamn comms person. You know what I was trying to say." And then he walks off laughing at himself. And I was sitting there going, what?
I'll actually, after the show, I'll share the video because it's a funny video. I was doing my cesspool segment. We were doing like kind of YouTube for shoots for Twitter and stuff like that. And I mean, I don't know if everybody knows this, but like when I do my promos, just like you, BK, I don't script nothing. I go out and I just fly off the seat of my pants and I just kind of say whatever I feel in my head, whatever bullet points I have, I try to follow. So just one day I was having a hard time. We were shooting videos and I was just having a hard time coming up with something. And I'll show the video later, but I'm cursing. I'm like, I can't get it together. I just can't get it together. And during the take, Omen turns this thing, looks at me. He's like, "I thought you were good at this." And I just laughed. And I said, "I'm supposed to be, but I'm just having a bad day." And he just busted my balls for the rest of the day after that.
He tells me I'm a comms person. Figure out what he's supposed to say, and he tells you
I have the video to prove it. I have the video because I recorded it. The cameras were rolling. It was me, Lex Umange, and Omen trying to film this. I just couldn't get I couldn't get it together. And Omen at the end, he's like, "I thought you were good at this."
All right, ladies and gentlemen, enough of us sitting here yapping. Time for us to put on the first match of the show. And making her way to the ring at a height of 5'8" tall, weighing in at 200 pounds. Hailing from the other side of darkness, we have Lilith, the Havoc Queen.
Lilith, the former OEW World Champion, is here today. I'll tell you what, Lilith is a big part of the OEW, and it's good that she's here to find a show.
Absolutely, you know, she was, basically the founder and the leader of Lilith's sister. People have to understand is that today the matches, except for maybe one or two, we'll get into that in just a minute, because the video for her opponent is now starting. Ladies and gentlemen, making her way to the ring, standing in at 5'10" tall, weighing in at 195 pounds. Hailing from the pits of eternal darkness, we have Sin the Phoenix.
Sin and Lilith, I mean, they were a part of the Twisted Sisters. They're going to take on each other today. It's unbelievable.
Well, that's what I was going to say, is that people are going to kind of be wondering. Yes, this is OEW Final Stand. And the reason why today is such a special show is that all of the matches today are either dream matches that they decided they wanted to find out who the best was, or there are some matches that are going to be done today that were actually set up to be at the end of at a super card that's supposed to end the storyline or continue a storyline. So that's why I was talking about today's a very unique show.
Yeah, absolutely. It's very unique. I mean, it's like you said, it's dream matches, matches that all our talent put together on their own that they want to go out with a bang. And, you know, I'm here for it, BK.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, great competition. And, I mean, to be perfectly honest, these two being in the ring actually is a dream match because they've hung around each other for so long. They've trained with each other. They are basically, you know, they call themselves the Twisted Sisters. They were as close as sisters. They know each other. They know it, exactly.
Like you and I, BK, like we knew each other better than we, you know, and we had great chemistry. And I'm sure Lilith and Sin probably have even better chemistry than we have because they've been around a lot longer. They've known each other a lot longer. It's going to be something to see this.
Well, I mean, they're actually having an argument with their mom over here where she... Now, that's something that they want to get in here in front of the moms, you know, because normally, you know, having siblings, when you get into it, take it outside. I don't want to see it. These two are actually doing something about it, and mom doesn't like it. Oh, okay. And then, of course, you know, mom says beat the shit out of each other. I don't care. And Enzo over here giving the mama... I don't want to say flirty eyes. It's kind of creepy eyes, but Sin and Lilith do not like it.
Yeah.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, Enzo just got his thrill for the day. He got to put his hands on two good-looking women, which is something that's never happened to him in his life.
Yeah, and Enzo don't know what they're doing here.
He probably not going to be able to call the match right now. Probably be able to pick his tongue up off the mat. And here we go, Enzo asking the two competitors if they're ready, and there's the bell.
Man. Here we go.
You kind of see the smirk on both their faces because of the transaction they just had with mom over there. And the mom's going to be mad at the one that beat the other one up. Oh, and Sin comes in and shoves Lilith down.
I mean, you got to get, I don't know who to go for it here. BK, because, you know, Lilith is a former OEW Women's Champion. Sin, you know, she's been here for almost a year. I mean, they're so equally matched. Sin could have been a world champion, too, if we kept going. I mean, they're so evenly matched, I don't know which way to go.
Well, it's always one of those things that, you know, yes, I agree that, you know, Lilith being, you know, on top of the women's division at one time, being a former women's, you know, champion, you know, that puts her in a very elite class. But Sin, you know, has just the same, like you said, has got a great skill set. Maybe that's what this dream match is all about. Maybe showing, oh, nice gorilla press from Sin, letting Lilith hit her face right on the mat.
You know,
but anyway, maybe this is Sin's way of saying, you know what, I'm just as good as you are. Maybe that's why she requested this dream match.
I'll tell you what, I'd rather be in the ring with you, fighting you, than fighting Lilith. Lilith's pretty tough. I've had my experiences with Lilith. I've been knocked out by Lilith a few times. And actually, I threw Lilith off a bridge and she survived that.
Well, you don't really have that great of luck with women, Paul, so I can understand that. Anyway, Lilith going in for a cover, gets a two count after a nice super kick earlier, recovering from that gorilla press, which I thought it was going to take more out of her considering the fact that she was dropped on her face. Then showing like her resiliency.
She looks like she's trying to shake off the cobwebs there because she got knocked out.
Absolutely, but like I said, these two have trained together. They're sisters. They know each other inside and out when it comes to being in the ring. It's going to be very tough for one of them to get the advantage, and mom's and Nene's just out here. She just doesn't know what to think.
Yeah, beside herself.
Yeah,
Nene's usually beside herself all the time. She's always mad about something.
What, two Nene's? Never mind. Shut up, Brian. Oh, nice roundabout right in the face of Lilith going right after her now, picking her up.
Wow.
Knife edge chop right in the chest.
Like I said, BK, we called it evenly matched.
Absolutely, because, you know, Sin was trying everything that she could, and I think she realized that trying to match Lilith with power wasn't working, so she goes to basic ground and pound. Now Lilith back on top. This has been back and forth ever since the bell rang.
Yeah, I mean, we knew it was going to be like this, and it's no surprise, and it's
hard Irish whip into the corner. Lilith charging in with the head of steam.
Uh-oh, she got her in the corner right here. Better get in there, Enzo. Oh, two. Kicks to the midsection there.
Absolutely. High knee lift right into the stomach.
Enzo finally doing his job and getting to the count. It's been about a seven count. But hey.
Oh, but Lilith is now standing and choking. Standing on Sin's throat, using the ropes as leverage. Somebody's going to get there. Somebody's going to take to the woodshed with my mama after that one.
Ooh.
And I dare her to yell at me and say she ain't scared of her mama. Now Sin gets pulled out of the corner by a wrist lock by Lilith, and then Sin reverses it. Yes, ma'am, I have. That's why I laughed when I said it.
Uh-oh.
Oh, nice.
Wow.
A discus chop?
Oh, and an
old school punch. Right in the forehead.
Right, that looked like the temple.
Uh-oh. Oh, and Lilith counters with an enziguri. I guess maybe Lil did listen to her mama when she was telling her, I'll slap the taste out of your mouth. Because that's exactly what she just did. I agree with you, Enzo.
They're both knocking the taste out of each other's mouth.
Now Lilith pulled by her hair, picks her up. Oh, tilt-a-whirl backbreaker. Jesus. Sin on the mat, crying out in pain. That backbreaker right on the small of the back. And I think Lilith can actually sense she thinks this is over. She's got kind of a smirk on her face.
Yeah, but she's not. She has a back turn, BK. That's a big mistake.
Absolutely. And she's showboating, giving Sin the chance to recover. Lilith is making a huge rookie mistake right now.
Uh-oh. Turn around, Lilith.
I not like it. Oh! And she turns around and, oh, and here's Sin just tees off on her. Using her like a punching bag in a gym.
Irish whip.
Big boot! Oh, vicious stomps continuing with the theme of using her feet.
Sin's got a lot of momentum. Now, you see, that always happens, BK. We've seen it a million times. You turn your back, you start posing in the crowd, and you pay for it.
Absolutely. I mean, there's a time and oh! Lilith comes in. He's got a choke.
She's got the Superman on. This is her finish. This is her signature, BK, the Supernova. It didn't look like...
Well, it looked like a choke from where I was sitting, and Enzo... Enzo didn't even check. So I don't know if he was sure if it was a choke...
Enzo's just looking around at all the beautiful women in the crowd.
Sin whips Lilith into the corner.
Oh, big splash.
Enzo telling him to get out of the corner.
Come on, Enzo, get in there, Enzo.
He's got his count started, and Sin's complying. She's dragging Lilith out of the corner. I mean, she's doing what she was told. Now Sin's got Lilith in the middle of the ring. Too much information there, bud.
Yeah, man, way too much.
Oh, and Sin with the roll-up.
One, two, and... Kick out. Looks like Lilith lifted her shoulder up there at the last second, BK.
Yeah, just enough to break that count, and then she used the lever to kick Sin off of her to get that weight off of her. I mean, you know, you've been in the ring, I've been in the ring. You know it's not easy to hold somebody else's weight on top of you like that and try to kick out.
No, not at all.
Yeah, Kurt, I agree with you on that one. Usually I stand behind you, Zoe, but yeah, not on this one.
And it looks like Sin is gasping for air over there. They both look like they're exhausted, but not giving up, PK. Neither of her. Oh, and the code breaker. Sin just hit Lilith with the code breaker, PK.
Absolutely, and I think Lilith was not expecting that because Sin was backing up. She may have actually been playing possum a little bit, making it look like she was injured because you were talking about her heavy breathing. I think Lilith dropped her guard just enough for Sin to take advantage.
Oh, spinning back fist by Lilith. What is this? Oh, looks like she reformed a shin buster there, BK.
Absolutely, and now Lilith is showing off that strength that we were talking about earlier. You know, the powerhouses, which is what Lilith is, all they want to do is keep you close, and that way they can use the arms and their legs and their strength and keep anybody from getting distance on them. And that's exactly what Lilith is doing to Sin right now. Oh, nice face buster! Just drove Sin's shin into the top of her head. Goes in for a pin. One, two.
Oh, only two count.
Only a two count. It's almost like I say this every single week. Somebody's dentist is going to be in a different tax bracket because that rattled me. Now Lil's getting back up.
Uh-oh, looks like Lilith's trying to... Looks like Lilith's a little frustrated by all this.
Well, I mean, look at what she's done. Look at all the impactful moves that she's using. You know, Sin keeps getting up, and Lilith is not liking that. What is...
Looks like she has her Romero special set up here. This big stretch here, BK. I don't know if Sin's going to be able to hold... Oh, look at that!
To the bow and arrow. And Sin has got nowhere to go. She is almost in the middle of the ring, legs and arms tied up in a very compromising position. She cannot get to the ropes right now.
And it looks like it hurts. That's the most important thing. It looks like it hurts.
Absolutely. Sin's screaming out right now. Enzo asking Sin if she gives, and Sin is actually saying no. And Lilith, for some reason, broke the move. She had her where she wanted her.
I don't know why she would break the move. It looked like Sin was ready to give up.
Absolutely. Gets up. Oh!
Yakuza kick.
Yakuza kick right to the face. Don't know where she got the strength to do that after that stretch she was put into. Nice spine buster. Picking Lilith up, moving her over towards the corner, cutting the ring off.
She has her back in that corner.
She could do some damage right now, but it looks like Sin is breathing really heavy through her mouth, trying to recover from what Lilith just did to her. Oh!
Exploder
into the corner!
That's it, BK. That has to be it.
Absolutely, with the force that was hitting that neck snap back, I don't see Sin moving at all.
Look at Lilith. They're both down, and Enzo got to start a 10 count here. They're both out.
Absolutely. Enzo starting to count. Neither one of them's moving.
Four.
Five.
Five. Six. seven, eight. Oh my God, BK, it's gonna be a KO. It's a double KO.
10, ladies and gentlemen, apparently, not only did Sin take the brunt of that and her head whiplash, but it looked like Lilith may have actually hit her head, and they actually collided. And Enzo has counted the 10, so for this fall, it is a double count out.
Double count, I mean, wow. I mean, they knocked each other out.
Absolutely, and neither one of them could get up for the 10 count. Well, I guess this, I guess the question still remains, who's the better wrestler?
I'll tell you what, PK, listen, I told you in the pre-show, I got a big, big surprise today. I went out, okay, in my months of not being here in OEW, I went out and I found the real hardcore champion. All right?
I found the real hardcore.
Hell, anybody can make themselves a champion. That's been proven if you're paying attention. So, hey, I found the real hardcore champion. I'm going to make my own champion because, hey, Let me go in and talk about it, PK.
Okay, well, before you talk about this, I got a question I got to answer here. I just got a question that says, can I be asked about my marriage? They want to know if I'm sleeping in the OEW broom closet and everything else. Everything's fine. Everything's good. You're not with somebody for 13 years in SL, which is quite unheard of, without being some bumps and bruises. But I'm going to go ahead and let it all be known. You all know it's wrestling. It was all a very well-written and very well-acted storyline. We do appreciate you all being invested in it. However, that is actually going to be one of the matches today that's actually going to end the feud on the last show when you are going to see Emma and Sacrilege in a Last Woman Standing match. Okay, Paul, it's all yours.
Hold on. I nude myself, so hold on.
You did what to yourself?
Give me a second. It's been a minute since I've been in the ring. I'm having a hard time getting in the ring, so just give me a second.
That's a first. Go ahead.
All right. Enough of this. So, as I was saying earlier, I said to you, BK, I told these people here in the pre-show, over the course of the last, month or so, people making themselves world champions without earning it. So, what did I decide to do? I decided to go around and find myself the real hardcore champion. I know not only just a hardcore champion, not only just the OEW hardcore champion, not only just the SL wrestler, the real hardcore champion. So let me introduce you now to the real hardcore champion, handpicked by himself, the scumbag superstar, Paul Slater. I'm going to introduce you to the real hardcore champion. Come on out here.
Okay, this is going to be interesting. Paul has found the real hardcore champion.
Don't be shy.
Wait a minute. Is that who I think it is? Ladies and gentlemen, Abigail, part of the Twisted Sisters, is who Paul... Wait, Paul
said... No, BK. Say it right. It's the real hardcore champion. I'm going to tell you right now. Me and Abigail got big plans. We're going to go and get press conferences in Germany, in Switzerland, in Ireland, in Olive Garden, in Roy Rogers, in everywhere. We're going to go and be the real hard champion and defend it all over the world. We're going to defend it all over the United States. We're going to defend it in Texas. We're going to defend it in Idaho. We're going to defend it against farmers, cowboys. We're going to defend it against everybody, okay? Because that's the real hardcore champion.
Paul, let's be real. The only way you're ever going to get anybody to come from around the world to watch you do anything is for you to go to Epcot
on,
and go to Disney and go to It's a Small World ride. That's the only way you're going to get world recognition.
Hey, we're going to be equal opportunist hardcore champion defenders. Like I said, farmers, 7-Eleven workers, Wawa, any of you think of it, they're going to be able to defend a hardcore champion. Like I said, we're going to go all around the world. We're going to get press conferences. We're going to come off planes. We're going to do everything. Because you know what? We're the real hardcore champions. That's what hardcore champions says. We're going to go on social media. We're going to do everything. So nobody in here, no one here from OEW is even worthy.
Okay. Hello, okay. Okay. So here, I'm gonna make the. Oh. Okay.
Hold on, Abby. Hold on. I just said, no win in OEW. Not a volcano. Not an earthquake. Not a hurricane. Not a typhoon. Whatever. No one here is gonna. What are you doing out here? What are you doing out here? Come on, listen. Me and Abigail, we have a tour. Hold on, BK. Let me finish here. Hold on here, Volcano. Me and Abigail have a tour of Italy. And when I mean a tour of Italy, I don't mean that we're going to get on a plane right now and go to Italy. We have reservations at the Olive Garden because their favorite thing they have at the Olive Garden for me to eat is the tour of Italy. And that's exactly where we're going. Shit. And that's where our tour starts. Yo, Broly, stay back. Stay back,
Paul,
me and you got
there
no
is
problem.
Only one thing I have to say about your world tour.
Okay. Do we got to do? Do we got to do, Abigail? Do we got to do? Hurry up. I don't want no problems.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, apparently we have an impromptu match going on here because Paul claims that he has the real hardcore champion here, and we actually have in the ring right now the Texan Predator Volcano, who actually was the very last hardcore champion here in OEW before the titles got merged into what we now know as the Women's Diamond Sands Championship. I'm sorry. I'm getting a laugh out of Paul and his world tour because, like I said, only way he's going on a world tour is to go to Disney and go to the It's a Small World ride. That's the only way he's going to get that done.
Come on, Abigail. Let's get our reservations are in 20 minutes.
Okay, Paul, is this a hardcore match?
You know what? Yeah. You know, it's the last show of OEW. I'm confident in my choice, BK. I'm confident in my choice. This is for the hardcore title, for the real hardcore championship right now. Come on, Abigail. Hurry up. Dinner's on me.
All right. Ladies and gentlemen, we have an impromptu hardcore title match right now between an... Oh! Volcano wasted no time and just took advantage of the hardcore rules. And let Abigail know, welcome to hardcore, bitch.
Oh, no.
Volcano wasted no time taking it to the quote-unquote real hardcore champion and has her in a sharpshooter while Paul's being chased around the ring by Broly.
Come on, Abigail. Breadsticks, Abigail. You love breadsticks.
Enzo checking on Abigail, asking if she gives. Abigail says no.
Yeah, you know what? I know she likes rum, but the breadsticks dry her up so she don't get too drunk. Calm down.
Yes, Paul, we know about your history with dry women. Anyway, Abigail's trying to make a comeback here, throwing some shots at Volcano and really not having much effect until that DDT. Abigail going in for a pin. One, two.
Come on.
Oh, Volcano kicks out. Abigail staying on top of Volcano right now. Hard Irish whip into the corner, but Volcano basically uses the corner as the ropes and slingshots out and catches Abigail with a nice clothesline. Oh, I think Abigail pissed Volcano off. She just got pulled up. Oh, nice! Snap! Jackhammer! Now Volcano taking a minute to get acknowledged by the crowd.
Dessert! Tiramisu! Tiramisu for dessert! Come on!
Oh, now Volcano has picked up Abigail and goes into the big swing.
No.
You and swing me right round, baby, right round.
And I hate to say this, but Abigail screamed out that she needs to acknowledge these nuts. Abigail, you don't have the right typing gear.
All right, Abigail. Free drinks. Come on, Abigail.
Free drinks. What's that like? Well,
They get free refills. They get free refills at Olive Garden. BK, shut up.
Volcano picks up Abigail. Got her in a very compromising position. Oh, Tombstone.
Oh man.
Volcano's laughing right now, looking down at Abigail. Abigail's looking up at the lights. Volcano goes in for the pin. One, two, and three.
Oh, man.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, your winner by pinfall and still hardcore champion, Volcano.
Okay. 90% of the time when people were wrong 10, so what is kind of that?
Well, the thing about it is you're more wrong if you wear it.
I guess, I mean, you want to go to Olive Garden afterwards?
No, I'm not going on a date with you. Remember, I got a wife. I still got a wife at home that I still got to make amends with. Hanging out with you would not get me on it. It would not get me in her good graces.
Take your wife to a nice little special dinner at the 2-for-1 McDonald's Big Mac thing. So go ahead, have a nice time.
Hey, it's not about what you spend on them, it's about the time you spend with them.
See, this proves my point. Anybody can take a belt and go on social media and be a world champion, if you know what I mean.
And Red Lobster doesn't have superior bread. They've got the best biscuits.
Hey.
All right. Hey. Okay, so I started off earlier, Paul. We're going to give the talent in the back there just a few more minutes, so we're going to take a break. You got another Omen story for us?
Yeah, I need a break. I got to regroup.
Why?
Well, I had to call Olive Garden to cancel my reservations.
You gotta call Olive Garden. All you gotta do is not show up. It's Olive Garden. It's not like you're going to, it's not like you're going to the Ritz or, anything like that. It's Olive Garden, dude.
Hey, no, they have a special thing in Olive Garden where it's just for me. If I don't show up, you know?
A special thing for you at Olive Garden, huh?
Like I said, I'm going on a tour of Italy today. It's my favorite thing at Olive Garden. And I might go to Germany and buy a nice German car at the car dealership because we're Paris and get some French fries, whatever. Hey.
Okay. I don't know how to respond to that. I really don't. Oh, my God. I have missed working with you, but not really.
Hey.
All right, ladies and gentlemen. Let us get on with the show with our next match. Oh, wait. We're not next match. We got a video promo. Okay. Oh, God.
I'm here today to sing and say the praises of OEW. When feeling sad or feeling blue, OEW's always there for you. For you, and especially for me. We would always rise up every Sunday rise up in something, something, something. And we would do things together. We were better than we could ever be apart. But now we have to start to be without each other. We had T.S.A. and D.H.A., Luca, Paul, and B.K. The Twisted Sisters, yeah, all three, and that dumb blonde Brittany. Skillex and Parker, and Danik Ogg, and that rotten bear. I really hated that bear. Karen and Saika, the brains and the brawn. Sacrilege and Emma can't get along. His heart is black as night. And El Cazador, look, I said his name just right. Superstar and Alex, Kua and Jet. I wish Tank was here to kick them in the head. Rain, the stormtrooper, Volcano 2. The dirty little feet of Daisy Sue. I remember some who came or left, like Honey and Dante, Nina and Moma T. Vex and Lex, Crystallia.
Wow, I was all into the song and everything. Oh, wow. Brittany finally gets her revenge.
Wow.
I mean, I like Brittany and all, but now I know not to get on her bad side by blaming her for everything that goes wrong.
Did we just witness a murder?
Well, the thing that really got me is the fact that after all this time, with Jeannie doing her singing, she didn't have her mask or her neck brace on, and then when she needed the neck brace, it didn't.
Wow.
Yes, yeah, rest in peace, Jenny Moore.
Wow.
That
took a weird turn.
Really did. I mean, my first thing was, you know, the old thing from South Park, they killed Kenny. Yeah.
They killed Jenny.
Absolutely.
Something tells me she'll be in a body cast next time we see her, if we ever see her again.
Oh, she'll come up with something. She'll have hot air balloons or something walking her or floating her around and while she's in a body cast.
Wow.
All right. did we just... Wow.
How do you go on after that?
Well, the thing is that we were trying to figure out how we were going to follow Derek Zane, and now we got to follow a murder. I don't know what we're supposed to do now. I guess the only thing we can do, let's bring out our next competitors. Wow. That's just... Whew!
Prairie comes, wow, I'm like speechless. I'm speechless for the first time ever. I'm speechless on multiple things.
Alright, ladies and gentlemen, making his way to the ring. Standing at a height of 6 feet, 11 inches tall, weighing in at 152 kilograms. Hailing from Donkey Ireland, it is Bannock the Renegade Hog, our current and final Diamond Sands champion. Unless he has to lose today, but I don't know who he's picking up.
The coolest here at OEW over the last few years. Diamond Sands champion. He's probably one of the best performers in OEW history, BK.
Absolutely, and Bannock's got a microphone. It's all yours, BK.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, children of all ages, welcome once again to the OEW Ascension for one last time. You folks, I just got a few things to say real quick. Everybody's been coming out here for a moment, but how the hell do I follow a murder? I'm just saying, just asking. I mean, yeah, that's what the white chalk was for outside. Yeah, I thought we were cleaning that up. Anyhow, all right, folks. Hey, listen, Omen, I'm the one who actually was the one who told the OEW and the wrestling world, as many people as I could, when I found out that Omen had passed away. I know he was fighting the same. He had diabetes like myself, and I know he had kidney issues when he was in the hospital and stuff. That was about the last time I ever talked to him. Omen and I, we trained together. We are one of the last big men in SL Wrestling. Yes, I've always been booked at 6'11". He's always been booked at 7 foot. So you guys, OEW here has been, people say we've been a land of misfit toys. We've been a land of misfit wrestlers. But we have been the land of people working together and coming together as one to make the shows what we do. Many of us in the back, we run several characters, several people to make this show go through. A lot of us also, too, you know, we spend a lot of time on merchandising. And one last thing we want to do is to thank each and every one of you for supporting us throughout the years. Now, if you look over here, up over here, we have all the posters that they could find of the current situation of the current OEW. Also, too, if you notice, I came out here today in my old ring attire, my old entrance song. That's my entrance song when I first won my first OEW championship. And as one of the Triple Crown champions here in OEW, I feel really, Paul and BK, I feel I have nobody left to fight here in the OEW. I mean, we fought every single person, but I'm going to give out one last open challenge to anyone who wants to come out here and take it, this belt from me one last time. Oh shit. Sorry, Nene, I would fight you, but I do apologize. I do not fight women. All right. Oh, shit.
Oh, man.
Bring the bucky.
Oh, crap.
Oh.
Enzo, here's my belt.
I was ready to get up, but the music hit.
You were ready to get up.
I'm respectful to the people who want to go before me.
Oh.
I know there's many places you can go with that BK. Let's just keep it there.
Well, trust me, place that I'm going to go.
Hey, Fanny, what's up? Look, we got Fanny in the ring. Where the hell you been? Oh, TSI, did you have to go and,
The challenge is the Samoan Thug.
So, I believe you issued shut up, please, thank you. I'm not trying to be mean. So, I believe you issued an open challenge, and, you know, I've been hearing you whine lately that there's just nobody in the back worthy of your attention and your belt. So, you know, I do have some Oh, well, this was my final play of the game. So, wait a minute,
Tiesa, hold on a second. I don't whine, first of all. Second of all, you're the one who's whining.
Oh, I'm so hurt. Oh, someone bought my company and put me in a closet. Oh, no.
Yeah, suck it up, Buttercup.
You know what? You've never beat this man. You
I
will
never
not
faced
beat
him
today.
I never faced him. How can you say that? I never faced this dude. I mean, Fatty over here should just go back to Dunkin' Donuts.
So well, stop running your fat mouth and wrestle.
All right, ladies and gentlemen.
Okay, wait a minute. I got one last thing to say. Tiesa, all right, here's what you need to do. All right. Okay, when this is all over, you need to go grab a cement brick, put some cement shoes on, take the long walk off a short pier, and see how you survive. Okay? Bye-bye.
See what he did there, BK? Pier, because our last name's Pierce.
yeah, I know. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm really surprised because of a lot of things that go over your head. Apparently, Tiesa is a little upset with Bannock by turning down her offer last week, and she has decided the open challenge is going to be dictated by her, and she has put Bannock into the ring with Ungonji, the Samoan thug, who is somebody that's been gone from OEW for quite a while, had no idea where she found him, but Bannock has not taken any chances, rolls right into it, several punches and a discus lariat.
I mean, let's be honest here, BK. I haven't seen this Samoan thug wrestle probably maybe once or twice in my time here at OEW, and I know he's been gone for a hell of a long time. The ring rust has got to be unbelievable.
Oh, absolutely. And, you know, could you imagine what a feather in the cap it would be for him to come in here, last show of OEW, and walk out as the very last holder of the OEW Diamond Sands title? Imagine what that could do for him in the future.
Oh, 100%. But, hey, what I just said doesn't take anything away from Ungonji. This guy's pretty tough. And we all know about that Samoans and how tough Samoans are. And this guy is one of them.
Absolutely. Comes from that long Samoan heritage, you know, that, you know, in all honesty, world famous. Nobody, you know, this is something that's known, and he's just carrying on the tradition. And there we had Bannock, had him over in the corner pounding on him, and he decided he'd had enough and just pray right now. But, you know, this is not – his opponent is not somebody that you want to do that to. You need to stay on him. Especially the fact that, you know, he is a very tough competitor, and the Diamond Sands title is up for grabs.
I mean, Bannock hasn't prepared himself. You know, I thought he was preparing himself. He's very in tune with our roster. I think he scouts our roster very well. But, you know, Ungonji wasn't on the rosters. I don't think he has any type of scouting report or anything on him.
Well, that's the one thing about, you know, about Bannock. And he's, you know, I said it before. He comes out here and he makes his open challenges, which, you know, I commend him for doing that. But the downside is you never know who's going to walk out here. And he had no idea that the thug was going to be here. He had no idea, like what you just said, no idea what to prepare for, and now he's going into this basically blind. And in a situation like this, it's one of those things that even though the champion doesn't have to win, Bannock is not a champion that's going to take the cheap way out. But the thug has got to beat him. And when he comes in, knowing TS the way that we do, she had this plan. She knew what was going on, and the thug has had plenty of time to be watching what Bannock's been doing, scoping him out, checking everything out, and he comes in here with an advantage. So Tiesa knew exactly what she was doing.
Yeah, she definitely knew what she was doing. She always one step ahead of a lot of people, and she was one step ahead of Bannock today for sure.
Absolutely, and the ref is up to six right now while the brawl continues on the outside of the ring. Right now, Bannock is down, screaming in pain after he got thrown into the steel steps. Enzo's telling him to get back in the ring. He's up to six. We've already had one double count out today.
I don't know if this is how Bannock would want to end his OEW career in a count out, BK. I mean, Bannock's always been a fighting champion here. He's always never back. Ooh, and a big super kick there by the Thug. Wow, the Samoan Thug just knocked the taste out of Bannock's mouth.
They did, but to comment on what you were saying, no, Bannock doesn't. Bannock is not going to be happy unless he walks out of here with the 1-2-3 or even a submission or something like that, because he's a competitor. He's a fighting champion. There's no way that he would ever be happy not winning this straight up and down.
No, I mean, it would crush him, I think, if he lost the Diamond Sands belt today. But the Samoan Thug is really giving it to him outside the ring.
Yes, more of the punching, please.
Absolutely.
And we're on a 3 count. It's the longest count I've ever seen in the history.
Well, that was because, if you notice, the Thug actually rolled in just enough to break the count early and then slid right back out before Enzi knew what was going on. So he had to turn around and start the count over.
That's why you're here, BK.
No, Enzo.
Catch the things I miss.
It's not hard to miss when you're old and blind like you are.
Eh, what are you going to do?
Anyway, got both men back in the ring.
Oh, 2 count.
And Bannock went for a quick pin and only came up with a 2 count. Very smart on Bannock's part after taking that abuse that he did on the outside of the ring. And right now, Bannock is in control.
Bannock is in control for now. I mean, the Samoan Thug has a lot in him. He has a lockup.
Absolutely. But like I said, the punishment that he took on outside the ring, you notice Bannock's not moving very fast right now. You know, Bannock, for a big guy, is normally very agile in the ring. And right now, due to the punishment that he's taken, he's not moving that fast. And he's almost like 2 steps behind his normal type of pace. And this has given the Thug awful lot of opportunities to counter and get the upper hand in this match. And now Bannock and the Thug exchanging very heavy fists to the face and to the body.
It looks like Tiesa outside the ring. It looks like she's getting aggravated.
Well, yeah, wouldn't you be aggravated too if you brought somebody in and, you know, you 100% thought that they were going to win, and now here they are on the receiving end of a very, you know, furious offense.
I have
you
a feeling that. I have a feeling that Tiesa would be aggravated if there was cream in her coffee and not milk. So, hey, she's always aggravated.
Well, you know her better than I do, so, yeah. And anyway, the Thug throws Bannock into the corner very hard and backs up, catching his breath. Bannock may be hurt. He may have taken more punishment on the outside of the ring than we thought.
You just look like a milk person. I didn't want to say cream. There are a lot of things that could have... never mind.
And the Samoan tried to back up, and he tripped, it looked like, and hit his head on the bottom turnbuckle. He's getting back up now. That definitely wasn't in the game plan to trip.
Uh-oh. Oh! You know how... Do you see the force... Did you see how fast this big guy just ran and all his force into Bannock's upper body? Unbelievable.
Absolutely. Did you see the ring shake? Did you see the rope shake?
Yeah.
That's a lot of force. That's a lot of man coming at you.
Well, here goes Ugaji with them foot chokes in the corner. Enzo, you gotta get in there and start that count. Start that 5 count, Enzo.
Enzo's starting the count, just like you said. He's up to 2, 3. Okay, looks like Ugaji backed up just enough for Enzo to stop the count. But now he's right back on Bannock in that corner, not giving Bannock a chance to catch his breath.
Oh, and a big head smash is now in the corner. Bannock looks like he's being taught a lesson.
Absolutely. This may be, maybe the last lesson Bannock ever gets taught. Yes, over here cheering on Ugaji. Ugaji, sorry. And now he backs up all the way across the ring. Bannock still in the corner. Oh, and Bannock rolls out of the way as Ugaji tries to... tries to smash him. Oganji did nothing but catch a mouthful of the turnbuckle. This is Bannock's opportunity to take advantage.
That would have finished Bannock off, and he got out at the last second. Ugandji's trying to catch his wits right now.
Absolutely. Right now, he's looking up and seeing stars. He has no idea where he's at. And if Bannock was ever going to take advantage of a situation, this is the time to do it. He's hesitating. He's still reeling. And now he's taunting him to get up.
Oh.
He gets up.
Oh, big spear by Bannock. That'll be it.
Boy, catches a huge spear.
And it caught Ugandji off guard with that spear. And I mean, look, BK, back. Oh, and another one.
Oh, and he goes down and goes from the spear and then goes right up into a ground and pound. And he is wailing on Ugandji right now. I think Bannock has had enough.
And Bannock has definitely had enough. Bannock hit that second win, it looks like, hit that adrenaline point. Now he's just going all in on Ugandji with that ground and pound punches.
TS is out here telling Enzo to stop this, but, I mean, part of wrestling. Idiot. And that what she called us a second ago, idiots?
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, what's she going to do, fire me?
The Swiss death.
Caught him with the perfect execution of that.
That's got to be it.
Goes in for
one,
the cover.
Two and three.
Ladies and gentlemen, your winner. And still, Diamond Sands champion, Bannock the Renegade. Ah.
Yes, sir. You know, I got a reservation for Olive Garden if you're interested.
Take it to Wendy's. Take it to Wendy's.
Nobody wants to go to the Olive Garden with you, Slater.
Yes, that's not what you were saying. It's not what you were saying in Mexico.
just take her to Wendy's to give the 4-for-4.
You're right, you were.
New Mexico on a road show. It was New Mexico.
It's actually a Taco Bell. Hey. I just like saying Mexico. It sounds more official.
Oh, okay, I got that. So, to you, Taco Bell is Mexico.
Taco Bell bathroom. Never mind.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, in case you didn't notice when you came in, we actually have some free giveaway shirts that's commemorating this day. We have the men's and women's over there, right there at the barricade as an entrance. So please, if you haven't had the opportunity, go ahead and that way you can help commemorate the show. So since this is the last show in this and that, and we get a lot of questions, once people realize what was going on. I got a couple of IMs. And I'm sure some other people did too. I can't speak for them. It's like, what are you going to do? You're associated with wrestling, when it comes to SL. And people know that if I wasn't wrestling, I was doing my photography. Well, just to let everybody know, Paul and I got into a conversation the other day. And we are considering, it's not in stone yet, we are considering putting together a podcast. And we're going to do a lot of what you all saw when our feud started here in OEW. We're going to do a little bit of mixing of stuff where we're going to be able to tell the stories in full length between what happened from RL and went into SL, how we became friends. And then we're also going to delve into other areas as well. And one thing that we are going to discuss, we haven't done yet, is we're actually going to start talking to some people who are involved in the SL community and stuff, and we're going to have guests, and we're going to let them, we're actually going to do things that nobody's ever done before. So once it all gets put together, Mr. Slater over here, who is a social media guru, please make sure that you're going to be paying attention to him, because he will be the one that's going to be doing the advertising. Oh, yes, you are. Yes, you are. Anyway, so we'll keep you updated as that progresses, and we'll let you all know what's going on. But anyway, it's not about us. This is about OEW's last stand. Paul, you've been here for quite a while. This will be an opportunity. In the time that you've been here in OEW, even here with Omen, and we are talking about Omen, what is one of the memorable matches that you can say that you called because you were on comps that involved Omen here in OEW?
I can't, you put me on the spot. I really can't. There are so many different ones. I know me and Omen talked a lot about, different types of things. I know I'm going to be honest here. The last time I spoke to Bannock, not Omen. He reached out to me, as far as like, you know, we were planning something, this past summer. And the one thing he did reach out to me is like, he's like, hey man, I'm going to retire probably, you know, he's dealing with some health issues. And he wanted to have one final match. And the one final match he wanted to have was with Lucardi Black. Because at that time, and this is going off script and this is going, you know, kind of like, you know, behind the scenes a little bit, but, we had the plan, you know, with pushing Luka to be the champion, and he was going to get the belt. And Omen wanted to do him right because he trained him. He wanted to, you know, put him over in his last match, which I thought was like was very, very selfless as far as for Omen. Like, he seen what we were doing, he believed in what we were doing, and he wanted to do the right thing, and he thought that would do good for Luka as far as being our champion. And that was the last time I spoke to him, Omen, and he was sick at the time, but he was ready to do that one final match, and I always thought that was just an awesome gesture by him. I mean, I seen a lot of matches of him. I don't want to know. I couldn't tell you right now what my favorite was. There's so many. But Omen was a good guy, man. Like, he was a really good guy, and we all had an idea, you know, we all maybe thought maybe something bad happened, but we you know, we couldn't find out for sure, hear from him for so long. But, we found out this past week with everything, you know, it was really heartbreaking, you know.
Absolutely.
Sorry, I just can't think of a lot of matches, you know, because he wasn't always on comms and he was always in matches. But the last conversation I had with him, that was the last conversation. I thought that was, if he would have done that, I thought that would have probably been his best match, in my opinion.
Okay, fair enough. And I got a story to share after our next match. But it was a match between Omen and I that wasn't a televised match. It was actually him asking me to help him do some training. And once again, Omen and his sense of humor left me standing, you know, with my jaw just kind of like, what? But I'll get into that after our next match. Ladies and gentlemen, it is time for the next match of the day. And ladies and gentlemen, making her way to the ring, standing in at 5'3" tall, weighing in at 125 pounds, hailing from Belfast, Northern Ireland, this is the Belfast Babe, Emma Gray. Now, just to let you all know, this match that is coming up, and like I said, we're going a little bit behind the scenes here, but Emma and Sacrilege had both pretty much made the decision that if they were going to go out, they were going to go out in style. So this match was actually set up to be at one of our supercards that happens in about 2 to 3 weeks, and they're like, no, we're going to end this the right way. So that's why we're having this last woman standing match here today on OEW Final Stand.
It's got to be a big match for you, BK.
And making her way to the ring, standing in at 5'6" tall, weighing in at 130 pounds, hailing from the Florida State Mental Hospital, Sacrilege. Well, I do have a stake in this, considering the fact of all the issues that's been going on and the brink that Emma has pushed my partner Z to. But to me, this is the only way this is going to end. This is most fitting for this feud to end this way today. No countouts, no disqualifications, no pinfalls, no submissions. Only not being able to get up by the count of 10 ends this match. Yeah, probably. I mean, you know, now Enzo can say that he has actually felt it four women in the same day.
So, like, yo, hold on. Let me get this straight, BK. The winner of this. How about we do the winner of this gets BK for a night? How about that?
The winner of this. You are trying to get me in more trouble. Oh, and we're starting right on out. Emma comes in and catches Sacrilege.
I'll tell you what, let's just talk off the record, like right here. Let's just talk serious. Emma Gray is one of the probably best female SL wrestlers in the industry we have here. And the transformation and everything she's done has just catapulted her to another level, PK.
Absolutely. This new attitude that she decided to take on, you know, right after Immortality has totally changed the way that people have looked at her, and she's gotten more aggressive in the ring. I mean, she was great to begin with. But then she, for whatever reason, she turned her attention to me, and you see where they're at, where you see where she's at now. Now she's actually having to, you know, they say there's hell hath no fury like a woman scorned. Well,
hold on,
people
hold
saw
on,
last
BK.
Week I got kicked out.
All right, hold on, BK. I said Emma was good at wrestling and her transformation was good. I didn't ever say that she had good taste in men, so.
Oh, you're just upset because she's not flirting with you. And Emma goes to the outside and grabs a kendo stick and comes back in the ring. Oh!
Oh!
Laying into Sacrilege.
Mm-hmm.
Neither women clearly had good taste. Well, apparently she does because it's been 13 years, Carrie.
And Emma's going to go out in style here. I mean, she's going to probably beat Sacrilege to death or send her back to that stupid mental hospital she's from.
Well, she may be. Oh, what's the matter, Carrie? A little bit upset because nobody can stand you for 13 minutes as opposed to 13 years?
Oh, burn.
Emma yelling at Sacrilege to come on, bitch, as she's choking her and then hits her with another kendo strike. She is being relentless.
And Emma's, the thing that Emma's doing right now is because she's taking her time. She's very calculating what she's doing. She's not rushing nothing. She's not, you know, she don't have all, her energy's very calm right now. She's taking her time with Sacrilege because right now, regardless of where OEW is going, where everything's going, this is personal to Emma Gray.
Absolutely. And she's telling Enzo to count, and Sacrilege has moved, and Enzo's not counting. Okay, he's up to four. And this may have actually hurt Emma because it took Enzo so long to get his head back into the match that it's given Sacrilege a chance to catch her breath and get up. Emma may have actually won that match. And
oh,
now
Sacrilege
is getting up. Sacrilege is now upset. She goes right after him. Oh! Nice belly to belly. Goes in with those vicious stomps.
Oh! Oh!
Catches her with a shining wizard. Perfect placement.
I'm alright.
Uh-oh. Now Sacrilege
going over here to the corner. Emma's not moving. Oh, flying elbow drop connects with Emma right in the middle of the ring, and Sacrilege is on a roll right now. Goes in and picks him up. Oh, DDT! Sacrilege staying on Emma, doing exactly what she should be doing, because, you know, Sacrilege is actually a rookie.
Uh-oh.
And the Irish Whip, oh, countered with a nice drop kick. But Sacrilege is a rookie, and Emma is a seasoned veteran, and Sacrilege is doing exactly what she should be doing.
I mean, Sacrilege, being a rookie, I mean, she's pretty goddamn impressive, PK. I got to tell you that.
Well, I mean, I trained her.
That don't make any sense.
But anyway, Sacrilege ends up into the ropes. Catches a clothesline, sending her over the top. Emma following her out. No countouts in this, so Enzo doesn't have to start the count. Except for when one of them doesn't want to get up, or can't get up, I should say.
Uh-oh.
Now, got her over here, put her up against the barricade.
Oh. Them knee kicks right over here in that barricade right by the entrance.
Absolutely. And that's one thing about the, you know, last woman standing match. You don't have to be in the ring to win the match. And right now, they're over here at the tunnel entrance.
Emma's shaking her head. I mean, look what Emma's wearing today. I'm so distracted. Never mind.
Be professional, okay?
I'm trying.
I'll try harder. And now Emma dragging Sacrilege over here to our steps.
Completely failing.
No idea what she's got planned. Oh! Reverse neck breaker right here in front of us. Wait, now Emma's dragging her. No, don't bring it up here. Paul's having tough time calling the match.
Here you want me? You can look and see in this guy. Handsome devil. Totally distracted now.
And I really don't know who caught the biggest brunt of that.
Oh.
Both women are laid out. Neither one of them's moving, and here we go. Enzo starts the count.
Well, the two count.
That was incredible that she actually jumped that far with no protection whatsoever. Nothing on the floor to protect her. That's just hard. That's just bare floor.
There is nothing to protect the silicone either.
I'm gonna let her deal with you on that one.
I'm just assuming.
And somehow or another, both women are up to their feet by five, and Sacrilege catches Emma with an enziguri. And now Sacrilege has got Emma, I guess, where she wants her. Oh, Irish Whip into the ring. Oh, and she caught the apron. Goes to a head smash. That is the hardest part of the ring. That is for where people mostly stand, so it is reinforced. Oh! And a hair snap takedown on the back of her head on the floor.
That's going to make Emma's face look like a hot bag of nickels for sure.
Oh, and Sacrilege is taking out all of her frustrations right now. Everything that Emma has been calling. Oh, Hurricanrana just dropped Emma on the top of her head. All this being done on the floor. Maybe Emma's going to learn a lesson. Don't piss off somebody's wife. Oh, catches her with the flip over stunner. That could be it. Sacrilege gets up and walks away.
Uh-oh, where's she going?
Wait a minute. She's climbing up on the... Wait, where? What is she doing?
Don't do it. Oh, shit!
Oh!
Oh, my God.
She uses the ropes as a springboard and comes off with a splash from the second rope, not even the turnbuckle.
Poor Emma's face.
it's not just that, but it's just like when Emma jumped off of our table a second ago. You don't really know who caught the blunt of it. Yes, sacrilege was on the receiving end, just like Emma was on this one, but you still got to protect yourself as a person performing, and the one slight wrong calculation absolutely did not see that one coming. I don't know where Emma pulled that one out of, because she doesn't have any pockets to pull it out of. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a highly contested match. These women are leaving it all right here in right here on the floor. I'm not going to say left in the ring. They're leaving it on the floor. This has been weeks and weeks of build-up coming to a head right here, and Sacrilege ends up going into the steps. Emma walks in, throwing some very heavy body blows.
Oh, and Emma's now Emma goes in against her face.
Absolutely. She's actually choking on her, and normally you see that kind of move being done in the corner where somebody has the ropes versus leverage, but Emma doesn't need it. She had Sacrilege's head backed up against the steel steps. No place to go. Nothing to give whatsoever. Just solid steel. And now Emma's dragging Sacrilege out by the feet.
Uh-oh. They got to get in the ring. Oh, no. Victor Four.
No, they don't have to get in the ring. All she's got to do is just make sure that Sacrilege does not get up for a 10 count. It could be out in the parking lot by the time this is over with.
I know, but I like that being in the ring, I'd be less more distracted by what Emma's wearing. I can't see
You're always going to be distracted by what Emma's wearing because you have a thing for, you know, blonde Irish women. You know, you being Italian and all.
You know, hey, we are who we are.
Yeah, exactly. And Emma telling Sacrilege, I'm going to make sure you can't stand up anymore. That's what the figure four was. She was screaming at her. And Sacrilege is, you can see right now, she is favoring that. She is favoring that. I thought she was going in for it again, but she's favoring that left knee. And Emma picks her up and throws her back into the ring. But Sacrilege, normally, when you see that, somebody's able to use their legs as leverage to get into the ring, and Sacrilege barely made it in. Now both women back in the ring. Emma comes in with the ground and pound while Enzo's trying to get back in the ring, and she is just being relentless right now.
Emma's being completely relentless right now.
Absolutely.
She's stay down.
Well, I mean, like I said, you know, she started this, you know, she caused problems in my marriage. And, you know, Sacrilege, you know, everybody knows the Z, is in there, you know, trying to avenge the fact that somebody's trying to weasel their way in and cause us issues.
I'm going to say something real quick, BK. I remember the video a few weeks ago when Emma was laying on your bed.
Yeah.
Caught
with the bloody Sunday. Emma turned around and was posing for you, Paul, and Sacrilege... After everything, I guess she got pissed off and she hopped up and adrenaline is rushing and now Emma is laid out.
She wasn't posing for me. She's calling you out.
I ain't saying shit. I'm in enough trouble. Anyway, the video of her laying on the bed, yes.
She's laying on the bed and you and Z had two pillows there. I'm not going to say what they said, but I am going to say very fitting.
Well, yeah, they absolutely are, because personally, to me, that's what she is, and I've always claimed that I don't want people to think I'm an asshole. I want you to be 100% sure. We're proud of those two facts.
All right, then.
Nothing to hide.
Oh!
Springboard!
She hit that lethal injection.
Absolutely lethal injection out of nowhere. I mean, you just saw you sitting there talking about what's going on and Sacrilege growled at me.
Yeah, see, hey, you're going to have a rough night.
Low blow. You don't see that too often. Followed up with a super kick. You don't see that maneuver used too often by the ladies, but damn. Wow. Uh-oh. Emma's screaming out, time to finish this. Somebody just yelled out that clam got jammed. Wow.
Sure did.
Oh, and Emma comes back in with the steel chair. This is not going to be pretty.
Uh-oh.
Oh!
Stop.
Emma laying into Sacrilege while Sacrilege is down on the mat. No place to... Oh, and again, Sacrilege is not able to defend herself right now. Oh, picks her up. Chair still in hand. Oh, throws her into the corner, follows her in. Sacrilege slides down, has no strength to stand up.
Uh-oh.
Emma setting up Sacrilege for something diabolical, I'm sure. Emma picked a second. Oh! Picked her up just to slam her in the head. Talk about insult to injury.
That just looks like it hurts.
Absolutely, and Sacrilege is just laid out in the corner, not even trying to get up, but Emma is staying on her. Oh, Emma's setting the chair up against Sacrilege. What in the world? Sacrilege is in the corner, not moving. What in the world is Emma doing? What is she doing?
Oh, she's down there, putting her chair up against that face.
Down there telling Sacrilege something and screams out, let's end OEW in a big way, and she's backing up. And Sacrilege is not responding at all. Emma goes up to the top. What in the... No, she's not. No. Oh, ladies and gentlemen, Emma just hit a coast-to-coast. Catching Sacrilege right in the face with that chair, and Sacrilege is out. Emma is down.
CTE, hey. We're not liable anymore. This is the last show. So if she gets CTE, that's on her.
Enzo's going for the count. Neither woman is moving. He's up to five. Ladies and gentlemen, incredible move we just saw. A coast to coast. Up to six.
Get up, Emma.
Emma's trying to get up. Seven. Eight.
Up, Emma.
Emma's up at 9. And 10.
Oh.
Ladies and gentlemen, your winner of the last woman standing match, the Belfast Babe, Emma Gray.
We're in for a rough night tonight.
Wow. I mean, in Sacrilege put up a fight. I mean, you said before, she's a rookie. She's a hell of a fight for this one. I know she was fighting for a lot of years. You know, just to be able to say, hey, I beat Emma Gray in the ring. She was fighting for herself.
Hey, Sacrilege gave it all. I mean, it was a great match both ways, back and forth. But, hey, we need a winner. And Emma Gray proved that the Belfast Babe is one of the best in SL wrestling.
Can't argue that she is one of the best that we have in SL wrestling, and unfortunately Sacrilege, you know, come up on the short end of the stick on this one, and you know, didn't, you know, end her OEW career on a bang. But this is going to be a learning experience for her. It's going to be something she'll take on, you know, later down the road if she gets into another fed, and it's something she can fall back on and use to her advantage.
So BK, my time here on the comms table is done. With you, with here, I want a few things I want to say before I leave. I'm going to talk about, you know, OEW, personal thing, OEW. You know, I've been here for a few years. Lex and Heather, they gave me an opportunity to tell stories that I thought would be cool and entertaining, and they gave me an opportunity to do that. I want to thank both of them for the opportunity to let me come here in OEW. I want to thank everybody here, whether you booed me, you cheered me, you hated me, you called me names. I appreciate all that, because my goal And our goal here at OEW was to entertain everybody. And I hope that at least I entertained you. I hope you all entertained you. But most importantly, I hope I entertained you. And I want to thank everybody here for all your support and everything. I loved going in that ring every week. I loved coming here on comms table. I loved starting a pod. I loved getting reactions out of people, and I really appreciate all the reactions, whether you hated me or booed or whatever. I appreciate it all because you were paying attention, most importantly. That BK, I want to thank you. You know, you and I, we have a long history here, man, and probably we'll have another history down the line. But for the things that you and I did, I want to thank you for teaching me a lot of things, for us sitting hours at a time trying to write stuff out and to entertain these people, bringing our personal lives in here to push the envelope even more at OEW, which I felt at the time nobody was doing in SL Wrestling, and we did it. I want to thank you. You're one of my closest friends here, and I appreciate you. And I just want to thank everybody again. I hope you enjoy the rest of the show, and thank you again for all your support.
Well, Paul, first, you know, we all want to thank you because, you know, all the years that we've been doing things together and we've been working together, it has been a privilege. It's been a lot of fun. There's been a lot of headaches. There's been a lot of heartache. There's been a lot of cussing. There's been a lot of throwing hands up in exasperation and all that. But I can honestly say that I don't think I could have worked with a better person. And like I said before, you and I got this endeavor coming up here soon, so we're going to be working together very closely, and hopefully everybody's going to join in and do it. But Paul, thank you very much, and
thank you. Thank you, BK. All right, thank you. Thank you, everybody.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, one of the best who ever donned a headset, Paul Scumbag Slater. And like I said before, he and I are working on something here, so keep your eyes out on that. So you won't be hearing the last of Paul, at least, you know, not for a little while, because, you know, there's very few in the business that does it like he does. But I was told that I am going to have another guest coming out here, and there his music is coming on right now. Ladies and gentlemen, it looks like the person that's going to be joining me is going to be the Diamond Sands champion, Bannock Ogg. Well, there he is. All right, ladies and gentlemen, the Diamond Sands champion, Bannock Ogg, back out here on the comms table with me. Welcome, champ.
What's up, boss? How you doing?
Oh, you know, kind of bittersweet. Having fun out here as always, but hating the fact that this is the last time I'll be doing it here in OEW.
Yeah, I hear you. I'm the same way right now. But you know what? We're putting on one hell of a show. Ladies and gentlemen, if you like what you're seeing, you know what? Make some noise. Let these performers know that you appreciate everything that they're doing.
Absolutely. Well, you know, still got a couple more matches coming in. Since you're out here, Bannock, I'll tell the story that I was going to say when Paul was out here, but I'll wait till after the next match and we'll get into it. I'm sure you were listening when you wasn't in the ring about us exchanging the only stories, you know, funny things that happened. Okay. All right. Well, we'll get into that. Ladies and gentlemen, let's go ahead. Let's get the next competitors out here.
Yeah, who do we have coming up? We got a barn burner, if I'm not mistaken.
1, 2, 3, 4!
Well, ladies and gentlemen, making her way to the ring, standing in at 5'7" tall, weighing in at 145 pounds, hailing from Deep River, Ontario, Canada, the OEW Women's World Champion, the beautiful genius, Karen Winter. And I also understand that Karen has a few words for everybody, so once she gets in the ring, the mat is hers. Always did like what you did.
Oh, yeah. Karen's a hell of a performer. I tell you what, though. What happened, though? Jenny Monkey earlier. Whoa! What the heck happened? Wow!
Yeah, I don't know, but I have to agree with you on that. Like, how in the world, even though, like I said before, Paul and I are out here on mic, and we're having to follow Derek Clay, and you got to come out and follow a homicide.
You know? What else do we have going on here?
We got someone Carter, you got someone doing this, someone doing that. But the main thing is that we are honoring Omen, one of the last big men in professional wrestling.
Absolutely. Ladies and gentlemen, OEW Women's Champion, Karen Winter.
Hi, Mom. Hi, Dad. How was your week? Mine wasn't so great. I guess you heard about what's happened here at OEW. I'll be able to come back for a visit soon, but it's too bad you couldn't be here. Just once. It wouldn't have killed either of you to have made the effort. Just once. But my parents and I, we've always had a complicated relationship. Sort of like the complicated relationship I have with all of you. And with this championship. Look, I get it. I get the weight of this belt. I get the responsibility. I get what it means to be a champion. I've earned it. With my toil, with my craft, and with my blood. And yeah, I'm a nobody from nowhere. None of you had ever heard of me before I got here. I'm not in five other federations. I never looked for other opportunities. I never asked, what about me, and when is it my turn? And I'm not sitting in some echo chamber with my best friends who just tell me how great I am. There's absolutely nothing special about me. I'm just a person who worked hard and made it. And I'm afraid of losing it, of losing this, of losing all of you. And I don't know what happens next for me. I don't. Tomorrow is a complete unknown, but today, right now, there's a woman in the back, and she's big, strong, vicious, formidable. She's everything that I wish she wasn't. And I don't know if I can beat her. And I want to know. So let's find out, okay? One last time. In this beautiful purple hall, let me be the beautiful genius, your champion. Britt, hit her lead.
All right.
What do we got coming up then?
Oh, ladies and gentlemen, making her way to the ring, standing in at 5'9" tall. Weighing in at 165 pounds, hailing from Battleborn, Nevada, the OEW Women's Diamond Sands Champion, Queen Psycho.
It's the queen.
Absolutely, but here's something that you need to know about this match. Now, and Queen Psycho wastes no time getting in the ring before the bell rings and hits Karen with her scepter. Telling him to ring the bell.
Yeah,
wow.
Yeah, she's over there. I mean, she just went into the stands, had a seat, refreshments, you know. Hey.
She's wasted no time. But, ladies and gentlemen, what I was trying to tell you is that, you know, for this match, neither title is on the line. This is just a straight exhibition match. Because if you remember the storyline, these two had just formed a partnership of sorts to take on the Twisted Sisters. And now these two who were comrades are now in the ring. I guess they want to find out who really is the best.
I guess so. I mean, you know, it's grudge match time.
Absolutely.
Stories are out the window. These are two people that really wanted to beat the hell out of each other.
Absolutely. And, you know, Karen says, you know, she's had a very, you know, roller coaster type relationship here in OEW with the roster and with the fans, you know, based on things that she's had to endure. And this, I guess, this is her one time that says, okay, you know what, let's do this. Let me show you the Karen Winter that I was trying to show you this whole time. And the only way she can do it is to take on the other top female, which is Queen Saika, who is the first ever and is going to be the last ever Women's Diamond Sands Champion here in OEW.
Oh, only a one count there. I didn't want to interrupt you there, but we had a close call.
Oh, absolutely. Lots going on with today being the last show, trying to call the ring and trying to get everybody caught up. Not the easiest thing in the world to do.
But I tell you what, though, you know, that pinfall this early, that pin attempt, that really, as you know, wears out your opponent because they got to kick you off.
Absolutely.
There's a two count. Oh,
Karen
nice.
Went in for a nice backslide.
Oh, yeah.
But, you know, something else that everybody needs to know about these two is the fact that, you know, Saika did, like I said before, she did win the Diamond Sands Women's Championship by beating Emma Gray a few weeks ago. And Karen is the two-time OEW Women's Champion, and she actually won the belt. Each time she's become the champion, she actually won and beat Lilith. So there's a lot of credentials going on in the ring right now, and these two are just going right at it. Oh, nice scoop slam.
She is just a Karen. Oh, my gosh. Really? Really?
And Queen ends up with a two count. Oh, your partner, Bannock.
I know, right?
Sometimes I wish she was, because I would love to hear her do a promo.
Oh, dude, she'd rip you up one side and the other. I'm just saying.
Oh, but it'd
be
fun.
She puts me in my place and, you know...
Well, I mean, we do.
King asshole
of
SL.
Well, I mean, think about it, though. I mean, she's a redhead. Z's a redhead. We're glutton for punishment. But
I
we
know,
love it.
Right?
But
tell
we love it.
It.
But we love
yes.
it. And right now, Queen Saika being thrown into the ropes by Karen. Comes back with a nice bicycle kick.
Nice move right there. Beautifully done. Here we go. Pin attempt.
Two. Oh, thought she might have had that one. Right now, Saika, wait, okay, here we go. I'm going to say it out loud. Another rookie mistake. Posing, this is not the time to pose.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, that reminds me of Twinkle Toes and Dipstick. You know, they used to come out here. Oh, look at me. I'm gonna pose for you. Yeah. You know, sometimes you just want to go up there and just take a pin and pop the balloon that they call
absolutely.
Muscles.
Oh, and Saika
nice
picking
move.
Karen up. Dead weight lift.
Oh!
Oh!
Beautifully done.
Jesus, she threw her up in the air and caught her in midair with the spear, but I think...
Karen actually came out with the DDT on that.
Absolutely. Talk about a counter of all counters.
Talk about awareness. I mean, you think about this. She just got tossed up in the air and on the way down had enough awareness to grab that woman's neck and DDT her. Wow.
Absolutely. That proves right there why Karen has been on top here in OEW for such a long time. It's just moves like that, being innovative, thinking on your feet, and sometimes throwing a game plan out the window to beat your opponent, because there's no way that she could have prepared for that.
Oh, yeah. No doubt about that. But also, too, because you got to think, a lot of these wrestlers here today, they're performing for their futures. Even though the OEW is closing, a lot of these performers may go on to other feds, and they're actually, you know, there's other fed owners watching this right now, and they'll watch us on YouTube, and they'll make their decisions if this, you know, say, for instance, Karen. Does
absolutely.
Karen continue on? Does Saika continue on?
Absolutely, and while you were talking about that, Karen actually hit Saika with a perfectly executed T-bone suplex.
Beautiful. Nice. Nice move. Also, too, you know what? I got to give a shout-out. We got the one in KC up there filming once again. We want to say hi and thank you to KC for all he has done.
Absolutely.
Nice German suplex right there.
And right now, Karen is the one standing, but if she gives too much space to Saika, that's going to give Saika way too much opportunity to regain her wits and to mount an offense. Karen, as good as she is, should know better.
Ooh, oh, beautiful!
I'm not sure if that was a fully extended drop kick. I think Saika moved in, and Karen actually ended up catching her with the knee instead of the extended legs, and that had to hurt even more.
Yeah.
And now Karen hops up to the top rope. What has she got? A
high risk maneuver.
Oh, nice! Moonsault into a pin.
Come on, Karen, you got to cover.
Oh,
cover.
She had her covered, but it looked like she may have landed a little bit awkward, and Karen rolled off of her before Enzo could get into the counting position.
I'm wondering if Seika caught her with her knees.
That's very possible. I mean, just the slightest movement. Well, Karen's hopping right on up.
Maybe she got hurt there, and she's done that moonsault before, so I'm pretty sure. I'm thinking Seika got those knees up.
Now, she could have, but it was just enough to keep Karen from getting the pin, but not enough to keep Karen down. Oh, and now Psy could go right in for those body punches right where she caught her with the knees, right where it would have been.
Yep. Hey, if your opponent can't breathe, they can't fight. Just
absolutely.
Saying.
Karen ending up over in the corner. And here comes, corner splash.
Beautifully executed.
And Karen is just basically punch drunk right now, staggering out of the corner, not knowing if she knows where she's at.
She looks like Bill Lawrence in the ring one time. You remember that? Bill was drunk in the ring. He couldn't find his way out of the locker room. Oh, yeah, it was bad.
I'm sorry. Wasn't that like every?
That's why he's in rehab.
And now we got Psyche cinching in a bear hug around Karen, and Enzo is asking Karen if she gives up, and Karen is saying, not a chance.
That is not a bear hug. That is a hugging hug. Jeez,
that's a hugging hug that.
That
just ended up in a belly to belly suplex. I got
you.
So the next time my wife comes up to give me a hug and tells me she loves me, I need to worry about ending up hooking up with the light. Okay.
Especially with Z. I mean, come on.
Yeah.
You saw what she just did.
I know.
Nice
wheel kick.
Yeah, nice. I mean, she jumped off that top rope into the ground, and that, let me tell you, that hurts. One time in my career. Never again.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I went off the top rope one time and never did it again. And now Karen cinching in the ankle lock on the queen.
You know, the funny thing is I'm up there, my opponent was on the ground, and I'm going, oh, shit, I'm scared of heights.
My whole thing was, what if I get up here and slip and nut myself?
That was my fear. Well,
and
you know, what worse is when they remove the turnbuckle cover.
Oh,
and
yeah.
And then you do the ball drop. The same.
Psyche had actually pulled and was able to get over to the ropes, and Enzo told her to break, and Karen pulls her back out and goes into a ankle lock.
An ankle grapevine right here.
A grapevine, okay.
Okay, yeah. She's grapevining the leg. What she's doing is she's twisting the ankle, twisting the lower leg, and using the knee joint to put pressure that is unbearable. I mean,
absolutely.
You think about it. A knee is designed to go front to back, up and down, not side to side. And that's
right.
What Karen is trying to do is take her knee and move it side to side.
Absolutely, and Karen was saying checkmate, basically that nobody's ever kicked out of this, but Psyche was able to pull herself under the ropes, causing Karen to, actually she pulled Karen with her upper body strength, and Karen, I think, landed on her head on the floor.
Yeah, that was amazing. I mean, you think about it too, that takes great upper body strength to be able to pull your opponent through the ropes onto the ground with you.
Absolutely, and right now, and Psyche is on Karen right now, just basically hitting her with everything she's got. Enzo, tell him to get into the ring. Nobody's listening right now. Imagine that.
Oh, yeah, what are they going to do, fine him?
Oh, Psyche kicked Karen in the gut, tried to run after her, but she's going for some kind of swinging DDT, and Karen ended up backdropping her onto that just unforgiving floor.
Ow. Yeah, I've been there before. Just got done going through that.
Absolutely.
I'm still over here in pain. Good gosh.
Enzo up to four. Enzo up to five right now. He's got half the count done. They've got to the count of 10 to get back in the ring if they want to finish this.
Yeah, if not, we're going to have a double count out. Drop toe hold. Oh, onto the steel.
Oh.
Karen's trying to get into the ring.
I hope Saka's got a really good plastic surgeon.
Yeah.
Now Enzo up to seven as Karen slides back in the ring but leaves Saka outside.
Yep, we got to start that count over again now. I don't know if Karen's going to... Oh, watch it. They're coming over here.
Saka crawling up the steps as Karen gets back on the floor, basically chasing after her. Saika's using the ropes to get to her feet.
Oh, you know, and I heard you mention before and how sturdy that spot is that they're on the rope. That is where the mat is not. That is solid wood under there to keep this, you know, or metal, whatever it's constructed with.
Right.
Oh, man, down she goes. So, yeah,
the way the ring is constructed is where they are is right below the ropes out to where Karen is standing. It's actually double piped right there. And then they have the plywood that goes around so that's a place where we can walk and we can stand and things like that. There's nothing in there. It's just covered. There's nothing there to protect anybody. There's nothing. It doesn't move. It doesn't give. It doesn't bounce.
Oh, she's on the top rope. Here we go. Oh, beautifully done. Diving double knee right to the head. Ow.
Oh, and Enzo may have to think about calling this match because Saika may have a concussion after that because her head bounced off this tile floor. Karen slides back in the ring, but somehow Saika's, I don't know if
she's moving. I think this is instinct.
It has to be because there's no way that she knows what's going on right now.
All right, let's see these two get in the ring. Here we go.
She's wobbling around like she's using the ring as letting her know that she's near the ring.
Yeah.
She's gotten back in. I don't know if this is a smart move on Psycho's part.
Oh, nails Karen over the top rope. Beautifully done. I tell you, she's working on instinct right now. I'm just saying, because that blow she took was a hard blow. Now, Karen's in the same situation here.
Absolutely. I don't think Saika knew what she did. I think she got in and kind of saw maybe a blurry vision, which you and I have experienced before, you know, when you get hit hard enough. And she may have just tripped and fell and, you know, got lucky and hit Karen, which she did, and sending Karen over the top rope. I don't think that was the move. I think that was pure luck.
Yeah, that's just, wow. Pure instinct. Oh, she caught her foot. Nice. Oh, beautiful.
And now Karen and Saika back down here right in front of us. Karen slides back in the ring. Slides back out of the ring. Poor Enzo.
Enzo is like, okay, come on out. One, two. Gets up to seven. He's breaking the ring. He's like,
I got to agree with what Enzo just said, for fuck's sake. Oh, wait a minute. This is now the second time the women have come up here around the table. Ladies, you got to get it back in the ring. Come on. Enzo up to three. Well, apparently me saying anything is not going to affect him.
Yeah, they ain't listening to us.
Absolutely not.
Pile driver. Ooh, is this pile driver coming up?
He's up to six. Enzo is up to six, and they're still...
Oh, no. Don't even attempt it. Oh, off the stage, onto the tile concrete. Oh, my gosh.
And that may be it for Karen. We may just see the last of her.
Oh, if she gets up from this, dude, it's
if she
amazing.
Gets up from this, it's a miracle.
Yeah, it's pure instinct at this point in time.
And she's not even moving. She just went head over heels off of this, and Saika's not letting her up. Saika could have won. Karen,
nice move.
How in the world?
I have no clue, dude. I'm just like shocked over here because as you guys think about it, Saika is 5'9" and you put Karen up, so her head's probably up another 2 feet. Okay, so she's up there about 7 feet in the air.
crashing down over 10 feet onto tile.
Absolutely, and the psychic goes in here, breaks the count again. She probably could have won the match, breaks the count. Right? Wait a minute.
Nine.
Enzo's up to 9, and neither one of them's paying attention.
10, there we go. It's the double count out. Go ahead, BK.
Ladies and gentlemen, both women have been counted out, so the winner of this match is no one. Double count out. So I guess we will never know who the better performer is between Karen and Psyche, because that's not how you end a match like this. Wow.
Emotional damage.
All right. And now Karen comes over and is helping Psyche up, showing good sportsmanship.
Wow. Wow, just simply amazing.
Oh, and there's a hug. They're hugging it out.
Careful. Watch that bear hug again, Seika. She may pull the belly to belly on you. Just saying. I mean, you and I go back to the beginning of time, I think.
Well, like I've always said.
I mean, think about it.
Well, like I said, you were here for pose ball wrestling. I started right after pose ball, got faded out. So you got a little bit of time, but yes. Because early, in all honesty, earlier, when Derek Zane was out here, he mentioned the APCS system.
Oh, yes.
And that was the first system that I started on, like you did, and like all of us. I did start on that system as well.
Oh, my gosh.
We've been around for, we still remember, a long, long time ago, I started on that system as well.
Hell, I was trained by a dune snowball and Derek Colt, if that tells you anything.
You're welcome, Kurt.
Thanks, Welcome to the club, Kurt. Welcome
absolutely,
to the club.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Us veterans, we've been around forever today. But I tell you, Omen really, really did a lot behind the scenes. People don't know this. He was a great trainer. Him and I worked on some things. When I came back and I was learning this new HUD, he did help me out a lot because, yes, I was used to the old HUD. As us old timers are, where you get used to something and then you got to switch and it's like, oh crap, now what? But Omen was always there. His door was always open. You can always contact him. He was always willing to help. He's going to be missed. He is one of the last great big men in I saw wrestling, and also, too, just so everybody knows, this is a little bit behind the scenes. If I'm not mistaken, he is the reason why I've been doing the open challenges. Him and I were supposed to work together, okay, and he got sick. Then I was supposed to work with Cherokee Martel, and then he passed away. But Omen's been sick for a while, and we've been waiting for him to come back, so I've been doing these open challenges to give some of these younger kids an opportunity in respect and honor of Omen.
Oh, absolutely. Really quick before we get to the last match, and I do understand that there's going to be something that's going to be done for Omen after the show.
A lot of people don't know this. Let me real quickly before we get to the main event. A lot of people don't know this. Omen used to be Dwayne Short. And Dwayne's last stint, he was copying everybody style. So I was fighting him, and Omen gets in my box. He goes, dude, we got in. What's your wrestling gear? And I'm like, okay, hold on. I'll make you some real quick. And I've built this guy a couple of bikes and whatnot. He was always a very, very nice guy. He's a gentle giant. In the ring, I used to be the asshole in the ring. Omen was a bad guy in the ring. But in reality, Omen was probably one of the nicest guys you can ever work with, and he will be certainly missed.
Absolutely. This is, I know we just found out the news when you told us, and it's been a couple of months.
Oh,
but
I was shocked.
But it doesn't matter if it's been a couple of months. It doesn't matter if it's been a couple of weeks. It doesn't matter if it's been a couple of days. When the news was broken, some of us responded, some of us, you know, dealt with it in their own way. And my way was just not to say anything and just to reflect, because I knew the show was coming up and I would much rather have expressed my sincere gratitude, my love for the guy, and my appreciation for everything he did, as opposed to, you know, just being typed out words. I'd rather have people, that's why I use today to do it, because I want people to hear the expressions and hear right. what he really meant to me,
yeah,
personally,
I mean,
and to the SL wrestling community.
He will definitely be missed. I mean, he was a great performer, great wrestler. And I tell you what, a lot of us knew something was up because he wasn't answering his phone in real life, wasn't answering Discord. So I finally got a hold of somebody who was real close to him in SL, and they did some research, came back to me and told me he had passed away in his sleep, though, thank God.
Yeah.
On May 31st. So, and with us just finding out, it's kind of like a brick to the face, because nobody knew for the longest time what was going on. Now we found out. So, yeah, may God have mercy on his soul and may he rest in peace.
Absolutely.
And speaking about resting in peace, you know, Jenny Malky, we gotta give her a funeral, you know. Now, rest in peace, Jenny, because that fall, yeah, never mind. That bear won, finally. He got the better of her.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, it is time to bring up the main event. And before we do, let me go over some stuff because, you know, like I said, this has been a very long show, but it's very understandable due to what's going on. But we still have the job to do. And normally I would be doing this part, and, you know, we got talking about Omen. So let me go ahead, and I'm going to go ahead and read off what you all need to know in case you've never been here, and in case of what's going on. So let me get through this, and then we'll go right into the main event. So we're back onto the show. Up next in the main event, we're actually going to have the OEW Men's Champion, Broly Blackheart, taking on Luca Bacardi. Now, these two do have a long history. They fought back at OEW Mortality. Luca defeated Broly for the OEW Medallion, and then Luca continued to fight until he became the OEW World Champion. At OEW Seek and Destroy, while Broly destroyed Paul Slater with various unorthodox methods, such as Happy Meals, a pot of mac and cheese, and pool noodles, at OEW Diamond Sands Day, Broly and Luca would face off once more, with the addition of Parker, the One, being in a triple threat match. Broly set the pace of the match where he dove off of the ladder, taking all three of them out, as Parker Irish whipped Broly into the ladder, knocking Luca off, where Broly did a rebound DDT to win the world championship. Now it seems only right that right here at OEW Final Stand, that Luca returns to face Broly one final time to try to win that world title back in a Falls Count Anywhere match. But also keep in mind, Broly does have Volcano with him, so you never know what's going to happen, because Falls Count Anywhere, that means there's no disqualification, so Luca's going to have eyes in the back of his head. So
Definitely. This is going to be a barn burner, to say the least.
Absolutely. So, ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, it is time for the main event. Ladies and gentlemen, making his way to the ring, the hated heat seeker, the missile with the mouth, Bacardi Embert, and he is accompanied by the Havoc Queen, Lilith.
I see this becoming a mixed gender matchup, I'm just saying.
Anything's possible today. Anything is possible today. I mean, we know Lilith isn't afraid to mix it up. Doesn't matter if you're a man, woman, alligator, Loch Ness monster. She don't care. She'll get involved in it because she just likes to
have it. What about a bear?
She probably would if she thought. She probably would, but she wouldn't do it to help Jenny. But she would do it just to prove that she could.
Hell, she probably trained the bear. Just saying.
Well, very true.
Yeah. All right. Who do we got next? Is it the champ?
Well, it has to be.
right.
And, of course, you know, ladies and gentlemen, making his way to the ring, the OEW heavyweight champion, accompanied by Volcano, Broly Blackheart.
Okay, now, you got to ask yourself, okay, you know, all these people out there talking about you and Emma, your truffle going on over there, or wannabe truffle, but I know you ain't doing that shit. What is up with these two? Where the hell did they get together at?
You know, they're, in my time here on Earth, it doesn't matter if we're talking RLSO. One thing that I have learned is there are just things in this life, in both worlds, that just cannot be explained, and I'm not even going to make an attempt. And this just happens to be one of them. I don't understand it. I'm not trying to.
I'm just over here like, where the hell did these two become an allies? You know what? They got probably going on in the background over there. Just saying.
Okay. All right. Luca.
Oh, imagine this. Luca's going to talk.
Oh, yeah. Surprise. All right. Here we go. Everybody, ladies and gentlemen, Luca.
Hey, Luca, you got to open the mic. Turn the button on. Come on. You can do it. You can do it. Hit the on button right there. It's a little switch. It sits up. Meantime, ladies and gentlemen, while we're waiting for Luca to figure out how to work a microphone, you guys, we want to thank once again everybody for coming here today in attendance. Make sure you stick around for after this match. We've got something special for Omen coming up. All right, Luca, did you figure out the mic? Did he figure it out?
Ladies and gentlemen.
Yay! He figured it out! Alright, I'll show
you. Yeah, figured it out. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, as you can tell, we're definitely off a little bit off script and a little bit off the collar here tonight. We're faced with a very somber moment this week. You know, October 23rd, 2019, a friend of mine was in a motorcycle club with me. His name was Damian Crux, and he asked me if I liked wrestling, and I'm like, duh, who doesn't? Because at that point, you know, wrestling was just an outside gig for me. Did some indies at one point, so, you know, that's neither here nor there. He introduced me to wrestling. sort of like what Paul said, in a sense, you know. He introduced me, he trained me, he trained friends of mine, he trained Lilith, who in turn got trained by me also, you know, so this is a very difficult moment for me now, you know, because I called him Coach. I always called him Coach. I never called him Omen, I never called him Damien, it was always Coach. You know, and he helped me out so much, and he helped me so many times with not only finding certain parts of myself, but figuring out this, you know, wild ride we call SL Wrestling. You know, so win, lose, or draw, this is for him, this is for Omen. And I want everybody to realize how much of a dominating, amazing type figure he was, not only for OEW, for his friends, for his family, for everybody that he spoke to. He was larger than life, and I'm gonna miss that. I'm gonna miss him in the locker room. I'm gonna miss him busting my balls. I'm gonna miss the match that we never had, that I didn't find out about until after he passed away. And it's really tough. It really hurts, you know. So with that being said, me and Brawley are going to go beat the shit out of each other right now. So let's enjoy that.
All right. Well said by Lucardi over here.
Absolutely. There's not a lot of times that I agree with him, but this is one of those days where I'm going to have to. Well, everything you say was absolutely right. You know.
Oh, yeah. All right, let's get to Shing Ding on the road. What do you say? The slap
absolutely. And once again, you know, Enzo's over here checking these guys, but it's the thing about it, it's a falls count anywhere, so that means there's no disqualifications.
All right. Now, ladies and gentlemen, make sure, since this is false count anywhere, if you all click on one of your favorite wrestlers, you'll be able to follow him wherever he goes. So if they do end up going outside, you will be able to continue watching the action.
All right, both men right in the middle of the ring, kind of jawing at each other a little bit, but that's, you know, that's their style. Both of them, you know, very accomplished athletes in the ring, but sometimes you kind of wonder if their biggest muscle is their mouth.
I think so, honestly. I think Lucardi's strongest muscle is his jaw muscle. Lilith's strongest muscle is her eyes because she constantly rolls them back.
Not for the good reasons.
I know, right?
Now they go into a lockup in the middle of the ring. Right now they're just trying to get a little bit of leverage. Broly giving away a little bit of size in this, goes in for a nice wrist lock, trying to control his opponent.
Now, Broly is a technical wrestler with as much, if not as much, experience, been in the ring for as long as I have, he's seen it all, so he should be good to go here.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, you know, a couple of weeks ago, I goofed with my history by when Broly was here saying that you and he, you know, had been in the ring before, knowing each other, and we were calling it. He said that you two had never been in the ring before, and I was honestly surprised when I heard that.
I am shocked myself. I've faced a lot of wrestlers through the years. I mean, over almost 15, 16 years I've been doing this.
Absolutely.
And, you know, there's certain guys who I have never faced, and Broly is one of them.
Actually, you and I've never faced each other either.
Yeah, now that you think about it, even when you were your alter ego, we never faced each other.
Right, absolutely. And both of them were one alter ego before I actually brought him in. We were at the Powerhouse together, and we never got the opportunity.
Oh, yeah, we were at Powerhouse. We were at VWE, or VAW, one of the two. I can't remember. My brain's mush anyway. He's been hitting that too many times.
Anyway, back into the ring, we have Lucario. They were sitting there and they were exchanging very nice technical wrestling moves. And right now, Lucario has got a wrist lock on Broly, and he is now catching him high, very well placed knees.
And once again, your opponent can't breathe, you can't wrestle.
Absolutely. And Lilith, stay in your lane, okay? And right now, Broly
got out of the way of that one.
Absolutely. And now Broly is coming in. Now they're back to the middle of the ring doing a circle.
They're doing a circle. Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, if Broly is not getting up, and I'm surprised Volcano's not over there trying to help him.
Yeah, so am I. I really am. Now, Lucardi's going to the top rope. Oh, there's Volcano. There's the nut job right there. She just pushed him off the edge.
Absolutely. I mean, she's trying to protect, you know, basically her meal ticket right now.
Yeah. Or maybe something else. I'm not saying, that's how we're starting. I'll start them.
I'm sure you would. Anyway, both men down on the floor right now. Women getting involved in this one. Lilith is standing behind Broly. Got the bat in her hand.
She just hit him with the bat.
And Volcano is not doing a thing. Oh, it comes up from behind and hits. Oh, okay, I stand corrected. And they all fall down.
Yeah. Volcano's over there. Don't be messing with my man. I'm going to slap you.
And right now, everybody except for Volcano is laid out.
Nap time. All right, ladies and gentlemen, it's the break to go get refreshments right now. Yes, it is. While these two men are trying to get up. Joking. All right, Lilith is up first.
Okay, I'm sorry, but AJ's over here making comments. I can't let go. Talking about they all got wood and snatching, and Z talking about snatching weaves.
Oh, yeah.
told you, I called it. It was going to be a big smash team.
And now, Lilith
is, over here.
And now Lilith and Volcano are going at it. Volcano just gets thrown into the barricade, and then Lilith falls in and catches her right in the mouth with a big boot while the men are trying to get up, and Broly is still reeling from hitting a flaming table.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, I do have to make this announcement real quickly. If these wrestlers get into the crowd, please do not get involved. Mm-hmm. They will hurt you. If they come near you, please move out of the way. We do not want anybody hurt.
And while we got Lilith and Volcano going off over here on one side, we got Broly throwing Lucardi into the barricade on the opposite side.
Oh, boy. This is going to be good. This is going to be good. All right, we got Volcano is still down, reeling from that back snapping against that barricade. Lilith is out of breath for doing a couple of
moves. Oh, wait a minute. What is this? Broly's going. What's he grabbing? Is that an Amazon package?
Oh, my gosh. That's what happened to my Amazon package.
Wait a minute. But if it's an Amazon package, did he use Prime?
I don't know. But, yeah, I mean, that. You know, I had something ordered from Amazon. It hasn't arrived yet. Maybe that's it.
The thing about it is what's in it? I mean, whatever it is, he just caught Lucardi right in the gut with it. I mean, knowing how my mind works, I could, like, go to some very bad places with how big that package is.
Yeah, well, it could be personal massagers for Tiesa.
Yeah,
could be Tiesa's personal massagers. Just saying.
Yeah, the
could
one
be her whips, could be her change, you know.
Well,
yeah.
If that's the case, then D batteries don't get it. It's got to be hooked up to a car battery.
Exactly. I mean, she went for the what was that? The premier model.
But anyway, now we have Broly standing over Lucardi, but Lilith has now turned around and she's not paying one attention to Volcano. Volcano has gotten to her feet.
Lilith is gonna get crushed. Volcano's gonna kill you.
I don't think of my boss like that. I don't think of her at all, because after today, she ain't my boss, so Enzo bite me.
Exactly!
She ain't my boss after today. Oh, and here they are.
Match.
And
oh,
now Broly is, okay, all right, ladies and gentlemen, you're going to need to, it doesn't matter how you
quick.
Do it, but they have taken it to the back. Yeah, all quick and fallen to the back. Broly has got Lucardi, and Lucardi throws Broly into the concrete wall. And I would warn anybody that's in the back, sound of my voice, I would move out of the way.
Yeah, you guys need to get out of the way back there.
Well, I mean, Emma's back there, so she's probably going to cause some kind of distraction.
Yeah, I mean, with the clothes she's been wearing lately, I mean, come on.
And now Lucardi goes over and once again throws Broly into the chairs that they have. They're waiting on our turns for our segments. Just threw Broly into those chairs.
Oh, nice dropkick.
And just put him head over heels across the chairs.
Now, see, if I was Broly, I would be ripping those earrings of Lucardi's out of his ear.
Right now, the only thing Broly can think about is what the hell did I get myself into? Because this is the side of Lucardi.
Pin attempt.
One. And somehow or another, just a one count.
Volcano got in there.
Absolutely, that's the only thing. That was the only thing, because what it was, I was zoomed in. I didn't see Volcano was out of my line of sight. I didn't realize that. You're right. Volcano caused that one count, which is the only way Broly kicks out.
And then Lilith and Volcano are over there. Oh, beautiful kick right there, right to the face. I don't know what was said, but I don't think Lilith liked it too much. Just saying.
Absolutely not, because now Volcano is looking up at the lights. Lilith is now the only person standing tall, and is she going to help Lucardi up? Is she going to go do something to Broly? She goes after Broly.
Oh man, this is brutal. Now, the OEW really men, but you know what?
But this is not
Lilith was a woman.
Okay.
Whoever said, do you have proof?
I've heard her speak.
Hey,
she's been out here on
comms.
Been out
here on comms. I can talk like this too, you know, silly.
Actually, I don't think you call that male on female violence, because that was Lilith actually
female
going after
male.
Broly.
Yes.
Damn it, man. I bet. You just fucked me up for the rest of this match.
I gotta go out with a bang. What can I say?
Wow.
He's got him by the back of the head right now. What the hell? Oh!
I just ran into the trash can.
Ow.
Hey,
that's
Jesus.
Gonna leave a mark.
Oh.
Oh, wait a minute. We got Lucardi perform the dragon suplex. Oh.
Really? That's how he ended up going into the trash can and dropped Broly right on the back of his head.
Wow.
Yeah,
well,
AJ
really doesn't have to worry about it too much because he's a blockhead anyways.
But
I mean, a strong head. So.
AJ, you're lucky. I have to be on mic and I can't control myself. Man, did you just fuck me up? Right now, ladies and gentlemen. Right now, ladies and gentlemen, both men are back here. Broly, somehow or another, getting to his feet. Lucardi getting his feet at the same time.
Both men bleeding right now from the head, as expected. Oh,
well,
nice punch.
Are they going outside?
Wait a minute. Is Broly cut up? His whole
well,
body?
I mean, what do you expect? I mean, look, what do you expect? God. What do you expect? You just got dropkicked over all those non-moving chairs
yeah.
that we have in the back, because they're like bleacher chairs. And then he
yep.
gets, and then he gets suplexed.
Oh,
into...
nice spear down the stairs.
Oh,
beautiful.
Oh. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the most vicious match I have seen in a long time. Talk about animosity.
And
please.
Volcano and Lilith are just standing around going, Tweedledee, Tweedledum, Tweedledee, Tweedledum.
Oh, they're not, they are not standing around. They have been involved in this match.
Yeah. I'm just saying, I mean, you know. Oh, man, Lucardi tried to get up and he just falls right back down.
Well,
oh,
I mean,
man.
He just got—I mean, he just got kicked down a flat of concrete
yeah,
steps.
Yeah, he's lucky it wasn't me spearing him down those stairs.
And now Lucardi somehow or another finding time to scream at Broly. He's a crazy motherfucker.
He's a crazy mother fluffer.
Well, yeah, that's
yeah.
not exactly
crazy
what he said,
mother fluffer.
Yeah. Yeah. Somehow or another, in the midst of all this, he's finding time to
talk.
And now Broly gets up while Lucardi is well doing the best thing. Flapping his gums.
His strongest muscle. Just saying. There's a muscle down between his legs. He's probably about
now Broly picks him up.
Millimeter.
And now Broly picks him up and he is following him with lefts and rights. Knocking. Oh, they're making. Wait a minute. What is it? They are making their. No. They are getting extremely dangerously close to our electric transformer out there. Our big breaker box.
Oh, crap. Oh, crap.
Oh,
Enzo, you need to get ready to get that electricity ready. I see this coming. Get the backup ready. Oh, here we go.
Oh, let's drive into the transformer.
Jeez, oh, man.
Oh, my God.
A back body drop into the transformer. The thing blew. Oh, my Lord. Sparks everywhere. Holy
crap. Oh, I hope. And a low blow by Volcano behind Lilith. Well,
see what I'm
I guess.
Talking about? Yes,
well,
what I'm
I,
talking.
Well, I mean, people have said Lilith has got balls, so.
Yeah. Hint, hint, nudge, nudge. Saying them all.
Wow, ladies and gentlemen, this is beyond comprehension what these two men are doing. That I think they said, you know what? I know this is last
show. Wait a minute. Volcano's dragging Lilith over to the other, what is that, our air conditioning unit?
What is, it is.
Oh, shysta. Driving that knee right on that concrete asphalt.
Well, actually, I mean, okay, so to let you know, yes, the breaker box for the main power got hit, but we do have generators, but the one they're close to now is for the AC, and I don't know if we have a backup generator for that.
I don't know either, but man, Broly's walking back. He's all bloodied.
And Lilith is laying into Volcano right now. Broly is on one side, is crawling to one side. Luca's on the other side. They're not even close to each other.
I think Broly said, that's it. I'm done. I'm getting the hell out of here.
All right, well, we were just confirmed that the backup generators automatically kick. Oh!
Oh my gosh!
Butterfly suplex into our AC breakers.
I think that was a release pipe suplex. I'm not sure, though.
Oh, wow.
Now it's really going to get hot in here. It's getting hot in here.
Don't you do it.
Wait a minute, Broly's getting out of here. Broly says, I'm done.
Well, Luca is on the other side. Wait a minute. Luca is somehow or another, he may be disoriented, but he's actually almost to the front entrance of the arena.
Oh,
and we were getting ready to move out of here, you know, once the show is over, and they have a moving truck out there. I'm afraid of what's going to happen. There's too much going on out there. Oh, my God. Okay. Luke
Marinda,
in the middle of,
Marinda, please be careful out there. Marinda, please be careful.
And Luca needs to worry about what's going on in his match. He's got the world champion to deal with. And besides, they're outside. That is the landing point. What do they expect? And Volcano catches Luca as he tries to get up and puts him into the big swing over the asphalt.
Oh, Luca, say hi to Omen for me when you get there, because you're about to be rest in peace.
Oh!
Oh, my God.
Volcano just released Luca, and he just landed hard on the asphalt while Broly turned around, and Lilith caught him with a bicycle kick right in the face.
You know what? These guys here just need to let their women fight. Just let the women fight it out. I mean, come on. I mean, let's face it, they're both keeping on the ground more times. I meant to ask Broly, did he find his contact out there? I'm just saying.
I have no idea.
Yes. Now, Marinda, please be careful out there, Marinda. Ladies and gentlemen, if they do make their way into the arena, into the crowd, please be careful. We do not want any injuries. What the hell does Volcano have?
Volcano has a sledgehammer.
Oh, dear God.
Lilith has her baseball bat. Broly is standing there. Luca, okay, so, oh my God. If either one of these men walk, actually, let me take it back. If any of them are able to walk out of this under their own power, it's going to be a miracle.
Oh, definitely, definitely. Luke, both men are back up on their feet.
Oh,
he ducked out of the way. He ducked out of the way, and she hit Lilith, just nailed Lucardi with the bat.
Absolutely, she went to hit Broly, and Broly rolled out of the way, and Luca wasn't even paying attention. He got nailed to the back of his head for his efforts, and now Volcano getting into Lilith's face.
Volcano, sorry. You were going to hit my man? Oh, hell no. And, you know, Lilith is over there. Yeah, I got the baseball bat, Louisville Slugger. I got a 400 batting average. Yeah.
Absolutely, and Broly is behind. And Volcano just tried to hit Lilith with the sledgehammer. Lilith rolls out of the way and catches Broly right between the eyes.
Oh, my Lord. Now, I think this show right here, ladies and gentlemen, is going down in history, not only as the final stand, but if you really think about this, we had a death on the show. We had a double count up. We had a double knockout, and now we got a hardcore match that's basically two men are being brutalized and will need hospital treatment after this.
Absolutely. This has been the most chaotic match I've seen, and right now you have, okay, so Lilith has grabbed Luca, Volcano has grabbed Broly, and instead of helping them up, both of the women are just dragging them barebacked, no whatsoever, dragging them across the asphalt, getting all kinds of rocks and pebbles and everything else, and they're dragging them over to the moving truck that we have. The big 18-wheel is going to take a lot of our equipment out of here later on today and tomorrow and throughout the week as we are packing everything up, but that doesn't mean that they need to use it.
Right, and the person who said this feels like a mixed tag, intergender tag, it actually does. I mean, I did call it earlier before the match started.
Because
you know as well as I do, BK, these two women were not going to just stand back and be like, oh, look at me, I'm pretty. Oh, hit him.
Absolutely.
And break a nail,
wait a minute. And we got, wait a minute. Volcano.
Water's leaking. What the hell?
Volcano just, for whatever reason, kicked the compressor that's underneath that cargo hold, because that's for taking, you know, all the frozen stuff, you know, things that we have for the catering and stuff for the talent, you know, after the shows and all that. And she's destroying it. Because that's nothing but, that's CO2 coming out of there.
Yeah, I mean, that was really
odd.
Interesting why she would do that. Oh, what the hell's going on here? Oh, they're back to punching each other. And the two women are just standing around looking. She wants to sniff it, yeah.
And now they're making their way over to the, they're in front of the merch store.
Hey, no. Watch the merch store there, you two. Spent a lot of time on that store, you know?
Absolutely. I don't really think they care right now.
No, they don't. Oh!
Oh! Ladies and gentlemen, we just had a propane tank to explode outside. Good grief.
Alrighty. Is this... Can there be a double count on? Marinda just ran into something, I believe. We got both men down right now. Both women are down. It's total chaos out there. Broly is starting to move. They're starting to move. Oh, it's okay, Miranda. Come on in. The front door is over here.
Actually, Miranda could have stayed out there and got a bird's eye view.
Yeah, I know, right? Yeah.
Just went out there and sat on the police car.
Yeah, I know. That's going to melt all the volcano silicone. I'm just saying. You know what would be cool as hell? You put a squeaky toy in a boob job.
Duh.
One, two, three. We got a winner. Oh, Broly covers them. Oh, my goodness.
Ladies and gentlemen, your winner by pinfall, the OEW Men's Heavyweight Champion, Broly Blackheart.
One hell of a match. One hell of a match. You got to take your hat off whether you like both competitors or not. You got to take your hand off to them. You really got to take your hat off to them. They put on one hell of a show. They put on one hell of a match, ladies and gentlemen. Once
Absolutely.
Again, your champion and still the OEW Heavyweight Champion, Broly Blackheart. Now stick around, ladies and gentlemen. We do have a special send-off for Omen. We want to make sure that that is the very last thing we do.
And ladies and gentlemen, you know, we've been talking about Omen during the show, and you know, Paul was able to, you know, before he had to leave, Paul was able to give his sentiments towards OEW and things like that. And this is something that I haven't done yet. I want to thank everybody that, you know, a couple of years ago I was in here, I was fired, then they got everything to be in SO Wrestling again, given the opportunity to come in here, and for the time that I've been back up until today, yeah, there's been some drama, yeah, there's been some setbacks, yes, there's been up, you know, there's been highs, and there's the highest of highs and the lowest of lows. I just personally want to thank everybody that stuck with us and everybody that has been a supporter of OEW over the years. And I personally want to thank everybody for letting me come back when I did and help me get to where I am. So hopefully this is not the last time we ever see you all, but unfortunately it will be the last time in OEW. So thank you all very much.
Broly comes over here, grabs his, okay, time to drop the formalities. And he grabs a mic in his belt. Well, you know what, Broly, BK has the right to say what he wanted to say because he's been here for a very long time. And he is a veteran just like you and I are. So, you know.
All right, well, apparently Broly has got something to say. So, Broly, champ, it's all yours.
It's all yours. Yep.
Four and a half years. Holy hell, I feel like Texas barbecue at the moment.
Ugh.
So I would like to thank you each and every one of you for spending the last 3.5 years with Over the Edge Wrestling. Me personally, I've known Omen since my days in DCWF, and when I came here to OEW, some of you might remember a character named Mr. Motor Nation Hal Jackson. Right. We put on one hell of a match at Immortality 2021. In that Lethal Lockdown match. And so I feel it's only right that I relinquish the title to its final holder. Therefore, ladies and gentlemen, your final OEW World Champion. If y'all have his music back there, go ahead and play it. The Omen, Damian Crux.
I'm the sickest you cannot define. With a nauseating smile in your mind. I am the end of the hate and the pain. You'll remember my name. I am your God. The Alpha and the Omega. Your beginning and your end. I am that I am.
Ladies and gentlemen,